So, hello everyone, a very good afternoon to all of you. I am Pallav, welcome you all again on behalf of E-Mobility Plus and First View Group to the first day of the EV Battery Tech 2021 virtual conference. So hope you had a good time in the networking session with your peers in our exhibition lounge. If not, you are missing the opportunity, but no worries, the networking will continue after the conference as well till 6:30 p.m. So first, let me give you an overview of the event. Here we are with the second edition of the EV Battery Tech Virtual Conference. This two-day event is slotted with an objective to match the OEM requirements with expert solutions and gives suppliers the opportunity to target customers investing in this high growth area. The conference will be featured with knowledge and technical presentations, as well as panel discussions from some of the industry's thought leaders. In this, we will be covering the market overview, new developments in advanced EV batteries, latest materials and technology, and the latest regulatory outlook. So now it's time to start with our conference. But before that, I take this pleasure to thank all our partners for extending their immense support to organize this event. So starting with our platinum partner, which is Ypsilon Advanced Materials Private Limited, our gold partner FEMER, industry partner Sigma Energy, knowledge partner GIZ, and lastly, our supporting partner WRI India. So now let me quickly take you through today's agenda. And we will be having two sessions today. That is India's EV battery market outlook, and the second part will be EV OEMs dialogue. So now I like to request my team to play the video of our sponsor, FEMA. Can we have the video, please? Can we have the second video? Great. So now, without any further delay, let's begin our first session. And this session will be starting with a very interesting knowledge presentation on battery cost projections for India, a case study of two-wheelers electrification by Ms. Sikha Rokadia, who is a consultant in the International Council on Clean Transport. Welcome on the screen, ma'am.
Yeah, hi Palab, thank you so much. Do you see my screen? Hello.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, hi. Can you see my screen, Palab?
Yes.
Okay, great. All right. A very good afternoon to everybody here. I'm Shikha Rokaria, and I'm a consultant with the India program at the International Council on Clean Transportation. And in my presentation today, I will be sharing with you some of our work on battery research as well as vehicle electrification in India over the past couple of years. And specifically, I will be sharing with you some of our more recent work on two-wheeler electrification as a case study to convey some of the key messages. So broadly, two questions that I'm attempting to address in the conversation today are, first, how can demand and supply dynamics influence battery and ultimately vehicle cost reductions in the Indian market?
Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am,
Yes,
but
please.
your slides are not visible.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay. Because I see over here that my window is being shared, and I even see an icon for stop sharing. So,
No, initially it was visible for a while, but after that
okay.
it's not.
Okay, what about right now?
No.
Okay, then can you advise me how to go ahead? I can either stop sharing from my end right now, and if you have a copy of the presentation, perhaps you could load it and then we could proceed from there.
Yes,
Perhaps.
that would be good. That would be good.
Okay.
I just request my team to can we can share the slide from our end.
Okay. Yeah, let me know when to proceed.
Right, ma'am. Yeah, it's on the screen, ma'am. You can give a hint to start. We are on the first slide.
Okay, great. Yeah, so my first slide was just an introduction. If you can go to the second slide, I'll continue from there. Great. All right. So the two key broad questions that I'm attempting to address in our conversation today are, firstly, how can demand and supply for electric vehicles influence battery and ultimately vehicle cost reductions in the Indian market? And then, from this understanding of key cost influencers, what are the key policy implications that emerge? And how are different types of policies interlinked with each other? Next slide, please. So, to set the context for where we are today and where we need to go, in 2017, globally, annual battery capacity was approximately 200 gigawatt hours. And by 2022, it is projected that global capacity will almost triple to 600 gigawatt hours. And by 2030, as leading auto markets worldwide transition towards zero emission mobility, annual global capacity is projected to be between 1.3 to 1.45 terawatt hours. And in this context, the India requirement is stipulated to be somewhere between 200 to 400 gigawatt hours. And by 2035, the India requirement is projected to increase to between 700 to 800 gigawatt hours. Next slide, please. So, if we take a look at the overall demand coming in from India on a segment-wise basis, we see that two-wheelers and passenger cars are going to constitute more than 50% of the cumulative battery demand for India by 2035. So, these two segments are going to be playing a very crucial role in influencing demand and supply dynamics and ultimately cost dynamics for the Indian market. Next slide, please. So through this case study, let me just illustrate how some of these demand and supply related factors kind of have an interplay with each other. Next slide, please. So firstly, to project battery pack costs for two-wheelers beyond 2020, we considered two market electrification scenarios. In a first ambitious scenario, which are the purple curves that you see over here, we assume that 100% electrification of new two-wheeler sales will occur by 2035. And in a second, more moderate scenario, which are the blue curves that you see, 100% electrification occurs closer to mid-century. And we further assume that both of these scenarios are going to be production-linked scenarios, meaning all of the forecasted growth in sales is going to be supported through battery production taking place in India. Next slide, please. Now we know that over the past 10 years globally, we have seen very drastic reductions in battery pack prices. So on average today, pack level costs are somewhere around $140 per kWh. And the target is over the next 3 to 4 years to touch the $100 per kWh benchmark. And you know, this pricing and these projections are associated with a certain volumetric output. And by that same principle, we assume that in India too, battery production costs will start to align with globally prevailing battery production costs once production in India starts to align with global production levels. So for example, we know that in the US in 2018, cell level production costs were approximately $128 per kWh. And this cost was associated with a production volume of 4.5 gigawatt hours. So in our market scenarios as well, when we cross that threshold of 4.5 gigawatt hours, sales threshold or production threshold, we start to assume that that benchmark cost kicks in. And thereafter, year on year, again, based on our industry estimates, we assume that cell level costs are going to decline annually at a rate of 7% per year. And then, of course, we have correlations in place to go from cell level costs to pack level costs. And when we apply all of this, you know, to our model and we see the resulting battery cost curves for two-wheelers, which you see on the screen over here as well, what emerges is that as a market, we are going to be paying a very heavy penalty for derailing from our ambition of rapid electrification. So for example, even under our ambitious electrification scenario, we see that battery pack cost curves for India are going to lag behind our international benchmarks by 4 years. And in our moderate scenario, this time lag is going to be 7 years. So the longer we wait as a market to really cross those early couple of millions in terms of unit sales or production, and the longer we take to ramp up giga-scale battery production in India, the longer Indian consumers are going to have to wait to benefit from globally competitive battery prices, which have already been achieved. Next slide, please. I don't see a slide. Pallab, I believe there's a slight disruption. I don't see a screen.
Yeah, I'm just checking with my team. Team, can you please help it out? It stopped in between.
Yeah, I see a slide now. So can I continue?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Please. Sorry for the little interruption.
No problem. No problem. So basically, I mean, what I just established was that, you know, we have to keep our focus on building up scales. And in our analysis, we not only project battery costs beyond 2020, but we have a model in place to project full vehicle production costs beyond 2020. And what you see on this slide is a breakup of total production cost heads for petrol motorcycles and scooters in comparison to electric motorcycles and scooters of different ranges in 2020 and 2030. And what we see is that in 2020, when production volumes are low, profitability is low, not only are battery production costs high, but simultaneously, we also have a very high indirect cost share that ultimately the consumer is paying for. So from that perspective as well, it's very important to keep that eye on scale to drive down these two key cost heads for the Indian consumer. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yeah, I think you've skipped one slide, Pallab. If you could just go to the previous one, that would be great.
Is it correct now, ma'am?
The one before this. Yeah, this is great.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So over here, I would like to draw your attention to how demand side policies, incentives in particular, can have an impact on supply and scale related dynamics. So for example, the chart that you see over here depicts how petrol motorcycle costs project beyond 2020. So that's the blue line that you see at the bottom of the chart in comparison to how mid-range electric motorcycles, so electric motorcycles with a real world range of about 150 kilometers. So how these electric models project in terms of cost beyond 2020 under different demand incentive scenarios. So the first dotted red curve that you see at the very top, those are the projections for the electric model under a no incentive scenario, meaning no type of subsidy whatsoever from the government. And we also take away the 23% preferential GST advantage, which is available to electric models in India today. And in such a scenario, we see that the electric model achieves cost parity with the conventional petrol model, not until 2036. So that is well more than a 10 years wait away. And when we start adding incentives into the mix, so for example, if we now consider the 23% preferential GST advantage, in addition to the earlier level of subsidies which were available under the central government FAME II scheme, so two wheelers, for example, had 10,000 rupees per kWh of battery pack capacity subsidized. So when we consider that combined level of government support, we see that cost parity now shifts forward straight away by 6 years. And the FAME II scheme has now been revised. You know, the subsidy outlay for two-wheelers has increased by 50%. So when we factor in that additional subsidy coming from the central government, we see another jump in terms of cost parity of 3 years. So now we have come from 2030 to 2027. And many states in India, Gujarat, Delhi, Maharashtra, and several others are now offering very attractive demand incentive packages as well. So as an example, if we consider the level of subsidy support available for two-wheelers under the Delhi policy, for example, we see that in combination with all the other central government incentives, now cost parity is looking within immediate reach. So demand incentives are clearly playing a very important role in making electric models affordable to the consumer and really creating room for that demand in the first place. And I'd like to point out that these cost projections correspond to our ambitious electrification scenario. In our slower moderate scenario, all of these timelines push back by a couple of years. So there's a penalty that we are paying in terms of a longer term dependence on incentives the slower we electrify. Next slide, please. Now, demand side incentives are one category of government policy interventions. We also have incentives on the supply side. And in India now, we see that there are some very attractive incentives coming in place available to manufacturers across the EV supply chain at different levels. So for example, we have the most recent production-linked incentive scheme for vehicles and components. And these benefits are over and above the production-linked incentives under the Advanced Chemistry Cell Battery Manufacturing Scheme. And these central government incentives are further over and above, you know, various bundled incentives that are being offered under different state-level EV policies. And these bundled incentives are in the form of capital subsidies, tax and tariff-related concessions, infrastructure benefits, finance benefits, etc. So all of these supply-side benefits, you know, of course, they are playing the key role of creating a very enabling, you know, investment climate and a supply ecosystem for the industry to come in and set up shop, you know, and to cater to the demand. But over and above that, what we see is that the nature and extent of incentives which are currently available in India today, you know, because they're available at so many different levels, it's quite possible that some of the, you know, collective benefit from all of these incentives could show up as, you know, a possible manufacturing cost advantage in the Indian context. So some of this benefit could actually be seen by the consumer as well. So just, you know, conservatively, for example, if we consider that a combined benefit out of all of these different type of supply side incentives is something like a $15 per kWh advantage in terms of battery pack cost reductions, we see that supply side incentives also offer substantial opportunity to give some kind of a leverage in terms of accelerating cost parity for the consumer by another few years over and above demand side incentives. So they're really supplementing demand side incentives in, you know, in terms of the larger picture of moving towards scale, which at the end of the day is going to reduce our longer term dependence on incentives as an industry. Pallav, I think I've lost the screen again.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Team, can you please fix it up quickly? I believe it is visible to you, ma'am.
Yes. So if you could just move to the next slide.
Sorry, one second for the little interruption.
Great. So I think I'll just conclude, you know, my discussion over here and kind of try to wrap it up together. So what we see is that, you know, particularly in the two-wheeler context today, it is a priority segment for India. The demand side policy scenario today is looking very favorable, and these incentives are important and they need to continue. Without them, we are not going to see cost parity in the near term. The good news is that, you know, things are on the right track. Everything is looking very good and very favorable in terms of economics. On the supply side also, we now have some very attractive incentives coming into place for the industry. However, when we analyze the trajectories of how electrification has been supported in other leading auto markets globally and kind of compare what's going on to the situation in India, we see that in India, for example, in spite of such favorable demand and supply side policies now in place, the overall sentiment in the industry, and these are the leading auto companies, you know, the leading ICE companies, for example, is still one of caution. So for two-wheelers, you know, the two-wheeler market, 99% of the two-wheeler market is dominated by some seven companies. And between these seven companies, we have two electric models and those two which are available only in limited supply in selected cities. And the missing link between, you know, the Indian policy scenario and leading electric markets and auto markets globally is that of regulation. So we are missing strong regulation right now. Regulatory measures that can address any type of investor uncertainty and industry uncertainty to really kind of scale the market and make, you know, bets on the market that go beyond just the availability of incentives. And if we look at the type of regulatory pathways that have been deployed globally, we have a lot of options that are available to us So there are mechanisms like zero emission vehicle credit mechanisms, fuel consumption standards with inbuilt systems to enable or promote electrification, registration, permit, license related mechanisms, as well as urban planning approaches like low and zero emission zones. And on this note, I think I'll just conclude my brief introduction over here, and I'm looking forward to a productive and good discussion going forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, ma'am, for this wonderful presentation, and very insightful it was, apart from the little interruptions. So now I like to welcome Mr. Gundu Rao, Gundu Rao MR, the technical manager EV from our gold partner FEMR, to deliver his presentations. Welcome on screen, sir.
Thank you, Pallab. Thank you once again. Hope you can able to see my screen.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Once again, good afternoon, everybody. So, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the welcome to the session on behalf of FEMR. So, I will just give you a brief introduction about what FEMR is offering with respect to EV chargers. So before proceeding with the product presentations, I would like to give just a brief introduction about our company. So we are a solar inverter manufacturers, and we do manufacture EV chargers as well. So we are into the into the solar business since 10 plus years. So with respect to capacity, our capabilities with respect to solar, we have 12 plus gigawatt capacity manufacturing capabilities per annum. And we have an installation base of 55 plus gigawatt across the globe. And with respect to EV chargers, we have a manufacturing capability of 16,000 chargers we can able to manufacture per annum. And we have installed approximately 35,000 plus chargers across the globe as of now. And with respect to our presence, our presence is global. We have our direct presence across 20 countries in 5 continents. And from those 20 countries, we are supporting approximately 100 plus countries. So our presence is, our inverters and EV chargers presence is across 100 plus countries. And we have an employee base of 1100 numbers. And we have 3 production sites, and we have 2 research centers. And we are into EV charging business since 2017. So this is a just brief introduction about FEMR. So with respect to product, before moving into product, so majorly we are focusing on residential applications where we can provide chargers to residential applications, and even for commercials and public charging stations as well. And our channels to the business is through utility and EV manufacturers, and even utility providers as well. So this is our business channel. So through this, like, we are planning to tie up with even EV vehicle manufacturers as well, so that we can support EV infrastructure development. So with respect to product portfolios, we have majorly 2 product portfolios. Both we have both AC and DC chargers. So with respect to AC chargers, we have wall box chargers starting from 3.7 kilowatt. And for public charging stations, we have AC station, which we call it as FEMR Flexa AC station. And for fast charging, we have DC stations. Minimum capacity of this particular DC station is 60 kilowatt DC. And we have one more upcoming product, which is a DC wall box of 25 kilowatt capacity. So most of you might be knowing the basic difference between AC and DC chargers. Just for beginners, to give a heads up about the difference between AC and DC chargers. So majorly AC charger is the charging sessions will majorly depends upon onboard chargers which is placed inside a vehicle, and whereas DC the onboard charger will be communicating with both external AC charger and BMS which is placed inside a vehicle, and accordingly depends upon the onboard charger capacity respective power will be pushed back to into the batteries. With respect to DC chargers, here we will rectification process, everything will be done inside DC chargers itself, and it will be communicating with BMS directly, and it will charge batteries directly. It won't depend upon onboard charger. So that's why we can able to push more quickly batteries, and we can able to charge vehicles more quickly as well. So that is the advantage with DC chargers. So with respect to AC wallbox, as I said earlier, we have four product ranges. We have 3.7 kilowatt and 7.4 kilowatt, which comes under single phase with nominal voltage of 230 volts. And with respect to three phase, we have two product ranges, which is 11 kilowatt and 22 kilowatt with nominal voltage of 400 volts. For both models, operating voltage range will be plus or minus 10% to the nominal voltage. And we have three versions here. The first one is standalone version, and to cater different customers requirement, we have standalone version and future net version and inverter net version. Standalone version is very simple and for majorly for residential customers. Any residential customer can install our chargers, just plug and play kind of a thing. With just one RFID card, he can start charging and he can stop charging. That is the advantage with standalone. And with respect to future net, it is majorly for public charging stations. So we will be having all OCPP control, all remote monitoring and control features will be there in future net version. So customers can go ahead with future net version if they intended to install their chargers in public charging stations. And third one is inverter net version. This is kind of, you can integrate solar inverter with EV chargers. So I will explain a bit about inverter net feature in inverter net version in coming slides. And with respect to AC station, this is one more model. Majorly we are intended this particular charger in public charging stations. So this comes with, again here, the capacity of this particular charger is 44 kilowatt. Simultaneously, you can charge two vehicle, each of 22 kilowatt maximum. So again, we have three versions here, standalone and local controller and future net. Standalone means it is very, very simple. Anybody can come over there in front of this particular charger and they can charge their vehicles. Very simple in a campus kind of a thing in MNCs and companies, they can go, corporates can offer a benefits to their, their employees to charge their EV vehicle to promote EV. And with respect to local controller, this is very, very basic thing. Again, with little bit of controls like RFID cards, you can whitelist number of RFID cards and you can distribute those RFID cards to authorized persons. So in kind of apartments and all, you can go ahead with these kind of charging stations and you can distribute those RFID cards to respective persons. And third one is future net version. Future net version majorly for public charging stations. You will be having all advanced features like OCPP control features will be there, through which you can control and you can monitor and you can control all the charging stations remotely as well. And billing cycles can be generated and the invoices can be generated with this particular future net versions. So again, few takeaways with respect to our AC chargers is, like, first one is multi-configuration, master and slave configuration. So which means that one master will be there of higher end version that can be controlled. It can control multiple slave stations, like, for example, future net version can control all standalone versions simultaneously, and you can monitor remotely as well, and you can do the load management as well. Load management, which one to charge first and which one to charge next, all those things can be done using this master slave configuration. And by default, we are providing card versions of type 2, and yes, we can offer even socket version of type 2 as well. This is, and even we can offer socket version of type 3A plugs as well. But in India, as a standard, now everybody is coming up with type 2A guns. So we are offering type 2 with both card and socket versions. With respect to communications, we are providing Wi-Fi and Bluetooth on the Ethernet and OCPP 1.6 in all our AC wallbox and AC stations. With respect to protections, yes, it is IP55 protection and it is completely anti-tamper. If somebody opens the door of this particular devices, it won't start unless if you close that particular. That kind of protections we are providing, and we are taking care of all the necessary protections. And third thing is SuperCap Manager. So SuperCap Manager means, for example, while you are charging your vehicle, if there is any power shortage, like if there is any power failure, means immediately it won't shut off because you might lose your data. That's why we are providing one super capacitor so that it can take care of the transactions which has happened during that period. You will come to know what has happened and how many units got charged, and you will all the data can be fetched back to the server as well. So customer won't lose the data in case of power failure. So customer no need to go ahead with UPS and all along with charger, because we are providing super capacitor, which can means even though the charging session will be terminated approximately 10 to 20 seconds, approximately 20 seconds backup will be there. So with that, within that 20 seconds of time, you can able to view all your data. So this is the Bluetooth app what I was talking about. So through Bluetooth app, you can communicate with our device, you can adjust the set points, you can control the set point, you can control the charging sessions, you can start and stop charging sessions, and even you can update the firmware if there is any upgradations. So, and you can even you can terminate the charging sessions as well through the Bluetooth, and you can able to view the logs and faults and energy details. So all the basic features can be viewed through this particular Bluetooth app. So this is what inverter net version I was talking about. So you can integrate with our storage inverter, you can integrate this charger with our storage inverter, which is a React 2 inverter. This React 2 inverter comes with batteries, battery pack of maximum of 12 kilowatt hour. So you, to the output of inverter, we can connect our charger, and communication will be happening between inverter and the EV charger. And all the details can be viewed through our Aurora Vision platform, so which is there majorly for solar inverters. You can able to view the data of even EV charger as well through our portal, which is free of cost. And this is about AC chargers. Coming to DC chargers, so we have a DC charger of 60 kilowatt DC plus 43 kilowatt AC. This is the basic configuration, minimum configurations what we are offering at this moment. So this charger comes with two DC guns and one AC gun. So minimum capacity of this particular charger is 60 kilowatt DC plus 43 kilowatt AC, and we have ranges of 90 kilowatt and 120 kilowatt and 150 kilowatt DC ranges. Along with these capacities, you will be getting 43 kilowatt AC as well. So output voltage range of this particular DC charger will be 150 volts and 152,000 volts. So which means that you can charge both four wheelers, and even you can charge buses and trucks as well. So we have wide range of operating voltage, and we can offer multiple configurations with respect to connectors. So at AC side, type 2 will be standard. Whereas at DC side, we can offer CCS and CHAdeMO, or both CCS or both CHAdeMO guns, or CCS plus CHAdeMO guns combination also we can offer. Depends upon customer requirement, we can offer multiple configurations. So, and the third thing is, like, through RFID card, you can control the charging sessions. We will be having emergency push button in case of any emergencies, and we are providing for communication, we are providing Ethernet, and OCP protocol will be there. With respect to protections, IP54, and with respect to mechanical protections, it is IK10 protected, which means that you can install at public charging stations. If there is any external disturbances also, it can withstand for any external disturbances also. And at any point of time, you can upgrade this particular charger from 60 kilowatt to 90 or 120 or 150. And we have a small tiny UPS we are providing along with this charger. In case of power failure, is that this UPS will take care of all the transactions, and customer will not lose the data in case of any power failures. So this is what power management, dynamic power management, what I was talking about, which means that in general, you can charge one vehicle at full power. For example, here I am taking 60 kilowatt as an example. You can charge one vehicle at full power, which is 60 kilowatt, or you can charge two vehicles at a time with 30-30 each. If one charge vehicle gets completed, immediately the power will be shifted to the another vehicle instantly, without changing, without modifying any settings manually. It is completely automated. And simultaneously, you can charge three vehicles from one DC station, which is two DC chargings and one AC charging you can go ahead with. So this is what one more key USP I was talking about. So you can upgrade at any point of time. For example, today's requirement might be only 60 kilowatt with respect to fast charging. In future, vehicles might get upgraded and it supports higher charging. In that case, you can upgrade to 90 or 120 or 150 kilowatts within just 30 minutes. We will add one more power module, and we will upgrade from 60 to 90. That's it. It will take 30 minutes to 1 hour to upgrade one charger. No physical changes required. And all our guns, cables, and inside components, everything rated for 150 kilowatt by default. Even though we are supplying 60 kilowatt charger, but it is everything, all the components are rated for 150 kilowatt except power modules. And key safety is very, very important with respect to EV station. First thing is like automatic retention of cable while charging. No one can able to open that particular port because high currents will be flowing. So unless if you stop charging, you cannot open that particular charging gun. And we will be keep on monitoring inside temperatures and status of all the contactors. And if there is any abnormalities we found, immediately the charger will immediately disconnect. And unless we clear those faults, it won't start charge. And we have leakage current detection as well. So we will be using RCDs like RCM, which is a serial current monitoring device. So it will be detecting if there is any leakage current. So immediately it will detect and it will trip the charging sessions until unless if you clear that particular fault, it won't charge. So this is about product. I will just give you a quick introduction about remote monitoring and controls sessions. Yes, we have our chargers. We have two options. One is our own portal, so which means through which one can control the chargings and charging sessions and monitor charging sessions. Meantime, we support even third-party remote monitoring apps as well. So it is completely open protocol. So as a FEMR, what features we are offering is like you can locate and you can map all your charging stations in our website, and we have both app version and web-based version as well. So you can locate, means you can locate the chargers, and customer can locate the chargers if you as soon as if you download our app, they can able to view all the available charging points, and they can go there. And with again, you can segregate your chargers with respect to charging ports as well. Like for example, in one charging station, if you have CCS, and in another charging station, if you have CHAdeMO, yes, it depends on that as well. You can locate. And you can billing sessions can be controlled, and billing sessions can be generated with respect to power, with respect to energy, what you are pushing into the batteries, or with respect to time also can be that can be done. And tariffs can be adjusted as per the local requirements. Like a customer can adjust their tariffs to with respect to their available, like with respect to how they are comfortable. For example, if it is 17 rupees on one station and 20 rupees, they can adjust it to another station. So that can be done. So you can even change remotely as well, and you can do the firmware upgrades instantly at any point of time. And through these apps, you can look at, like, customer can able to view whether that particular charging station is really available, or it is busy, or it is occupied, or it is under maintenance. All those things can be viewed. And once the charging session completes, respective messages will be sent to the registered mobile number, and invoices can be emailed to the respective customer to the given email address. So all these features is available, and we have different levels of controls, one for the installer and one for the end user as well. So that level of controls also there with our apps. And apart from this, we have future, means we are working on future developments. We have a FEMR Hyperfast Charger, which is a 300 kilowatt charger. Here, it is a very simple concept where we will be having big conversion cabin of 300 kilowatt cabin will be there. From there, you will be having, we will be providing multiple outlets, which means that simultaneously you can charge more number of vehicles, and with the two with fast charging capability. So that is this is one charger we are working on. And second thing is DC wall box, as I said earlier, which is of 25 kilowatt capacity with single gun or two guns. Multiple options are available on these two products we are working it on. So most probably by 2022 we will be launching these two products into the Indian market. And this is one installation reference where we installed our EV charger along with reactive inverter. This is an inverter net version. So this is IASC Bangalore, where they are not using any external grid power to charge their vehicles. They are completely using solar. So they have installed 6 kilowatt of charger solar, and through that they are charging their vehicles if there is no power. So they will charge vehicle through the batteries. Like if there is no sufficient solar, they are charging their vehicles through the batteries. So this is one installation reference for your information. So that's it from my end. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir, for this insightful and interesting presentations. So now let me see if everyone is with me. And should we start the panel discussion now? Can you just respond with your, the emojis we are having at the bottom? Okay. So to begin the first panel discussion, which is on India's EV battery market outlook, And to discuss with this, we have in the panel with us Dr. Parveen Kumar, who is a senior manager, electric vehicle, sustainable cities, WRI India, who will also be moderating the session. Mr. Devasis Aneja, sector lead of auto and EV Invest India. Ms. Arishna Saxena, senior investment specialist, Invest India. Mr. Sika Rukadia, consultant, the International Council for Clear Transport, Transportations. Mr. Gerald Olivier, lead transport specialist, the World Bank. And Mr. Dipti Lavyaswamy, partner, HSA Advocates. So now I welcome all of our esteemed panelists on the screen and request Dr. Parveen to lead the discussions. But before that, here I would like to make a small announcement for all of our attendees. If you have any questions during the discussion, please post them in the Q&A box. Our panelists will take all the questions at the end of the discussions. So over to you, Dr. Parveen.
Parveen, I think you're on mute.
Excuse me, Dr. Parveen, you are not audible, sir. You are not audible at all. No, it's not working, sir. I request from the panelists if anyone can respond if it is audible at their end.
No, it's not audible to me.
It's not to me either.
Not to me either.
Dr. Parveen, I request if you can rejoin. But if there is an audio issue, you can just, switch off your camera.
Hello, I'm
Hello, Dr. Parveen, are you back?
Come inside.
So can you please unmute yourself? So you are audible now. Can you just unmute yourself? Okay, I think we have lost the connections with Dr. Parveen. Can I request Dr. Dev Asis Aneja to lead the discussion for the time being, sir?
Sure, Praveen. Let's do that. So, hi everyone. Good afternoon. Thanks for having us here. From Invest India's perspective, it's Arishna and myself. So, for those of you who don't know what Invest India is, it's the National Investment Promotion and Facilitation Agency. We come under the Ministry of Commerce, and the main mandate we have is to promote and facilitate FDI into the country. So, we are working extensively with foreign companies on the bordering side of things, which is the focus for this particular event. So, what we'll talk about is we'll talk about some perspective from the investment side. We'll talk about the challenges, what we believe is India facing from a battery technology perspective. And then I'll pass on the baton to Arishna, who will be talking about the technology landscape, the kind of technologies we are seeing in the Indian market, which are coming up from a PLI perspective. So, for the past 6 months, we are working on the PLI ACC scheme on various fronts. We are engaging with cell manufacturing companies worldwide, supply chain companies, which majorly happen to be electrode manufacturing companies. Then we are parallelly working with Indian companies who are looking to diversify within the cell manufacturing space, who are looking for joint venture partners. And also we are working with some global funds, and we are seeing active interest from some Middle Eastern companies who are willing to sort of invest into these cell manufacturing consortiums. So we are working with Indian companies across auto sector, energy, oil and gas and chemicals. So we generally see a good amount of traction happening on the cell manufacturing side, both from the Indian as well as global side, from a cell manufacturing perspective. Also, there are some funds who are showing active interest to invest into these consortiums. And also there are a few, supply chain companies, cathode manufacturing companies with whom we are in discussions from an India investment perspective. So we are extremely bullish on this cell manufacturing thing, and we believe this could be a good sort of a trigger to boost the entire EV ecosystem in India. This will have big enough major ripple effects on the entire ecosystem per se of OEMs, fleet operators, charging players, NBFCs, financial institutions, and so on and so forth. However, in terms of challenges, we definitely see we need to overcome a lot of challenges. I'll talk about three of them for now. Two of them are related to raw materials. So before we talk of challenges, let's take a step back to understand what sort of materials actually go inside these batteries. So if you talk about lithium, it's majorly concentrated in South America. Over 50% of global reserves are in the ABC triangle of Argentina, Bolivia, and Chile. Nickel, again, concentrated heavily in the likes of Indonesia, Russia, to some extent in Philippines. Cobalt, more than 60% is concentrated in Congo. And India does have decent amount of raw materials in terms of manganese, aluminium, and graphite, which are in abundance. Lithium, we have recently identified some reserves in southern part of India in Karnataka, but from a nickel and cobalt perspective, we definitely do not have them much. So the first challenge we have is geographical concentration of these reserves. Second challenge we see is chemical processing capabilities. So right now, if we look at the global front, most of the chemical processing of these minerals is being done by China, more than 80% of this. So what's happening is, for example, lithium from Latin America or cobalt from Congo, Africa, is traveling all the way to China, wherein we have economies of scale for processing these minerals. We have the requisite technologies. We are doing it in a cost-efficient manner. So all of this raw material is traveling from Latin America, Africa to China. Then after processing, it's traveling to, let's say, cathode manufacturing players in Japan, Korea, and other parts of the world. Then these cathodes and electrodes travel all the way to US, Europe, wherever the end consumer or the gigafactories are. So by some estimates, over 50,000 miles of travel is happening for these raw materials from one end of the world to the other. And this travel might not be happening in the most efficient or the most green, ecologically friendly manner. So when we talk about these battery supply chain activities, a lot of it right now is not happening in a green manner, which definitely should be the case. From a financial perspective, a lot of inefficiencies are there from a logistics standpoint because of geographical concentration and because of concentration of chemical processing capabilities in China. So we from an India perspective definitely need to sort of enhance our chemical processing capabilities, we need to invite supply chain companies to come and process these minerals in India, so that at least the logistics part is taken care of, both from a green energy, from a greener perspective, as well as from a financial perspective. In this year alone, globally, we have seen, because of these supply chain issues and logistics issues, we have seen a lot of price volatility. For example, the prices of lithium carbonate and lithium hydroxide has already skyrocketed by over 40% in this year. And if this trend continues, we will sort of nullify all of our efforts, global efforts, on enhancing the manufacturing efficiencies. So this geographical concentration risk definitely needs to be taken care of. And in India, we are trying to work with a lot of supply chain companies who have the capabilities to process these minerals in India. So we do have some chemical companies who already have processing capabilities, but they are not making battery grade materials, because as of now, there is no battery manufacturing happening in India. But now, with the likes of global companies who are exploring the Indian market, and they're exploring some joint ventures with Indian chemical companies, we are hopeful that this challenge will be taken care of in the next 24 months. We'll see where it goes. And Arishna, my colleague Arishna, will further talk on the technology front, the kind of technologies we are facilitating right now in the Indian market. Thirdly, I want to touch upon the safety aspect. If we look at the cell manufacturing industry, it's sort of split into tier 1 players, tier 2 players, tier 3 players, with tier 1 cells being cells from the likes of Panasonic, Samsung, LG Chem, and most of the tier 2 and tier 3 players are Chinese players, or these are also called as B-grade cells. What's happening in India is, since it's a cost-sensitive market and most of these cells are going into low-performance two-wheelers and three-wheelers, a lot of import of cells which is happening is of B-grade cells in the Indian market, and we do not have the controls, quality controls and checks on these imports right now. So it's sort of high time that we start having those checks and balances in place to ensure that there is a high amount of safety in these vehicles. We recently saw some accidents in terms of explosions of Okinawa scooters, simple EV scooters, pure EV scooters. So these sort of instances, of course, should not happen in the future. For that, we need to have, from a policy standpoint, we need to work on improving the quality of these imports. And once we have the ACC policy sort of action on the ground, we'll definitely have these cells localized, which can basically take care of quality to some extent, because the incentives in this policy are basically based on the quality of these cells, in terms of energy density, in terms of cycle life, the retention power of these cells, and so on and so forth. So once these performance parameters are taken care of, which we are working towards, we believe the safety aspect to quite an extent will be taken care of. That's what our take is on the perspective, on which we are extremely bullish. The kind of activity we are seeing from all the fronts, be it Indian companies, be it cell manufacturing global companies, be it supply chain companies or the funds, and the challenges which we spoke about, definitely we are doing some action from a policy standpoint, and we are hopeful things will improve in the coming times, especially with the localization expected to happen. And now I'll pass on the baton to my colleague Arishna, who will give you a bird's eye view of the technology landscape which we are witnessing in the Indian market. Over to you, Arishna. Yeah,
thank you, Dev. Good afternoon. Great inputs by everybody. I particularly enjoyed the presentation by Shikha. It was really informative. So yeah, I'll be talking about the battery technology landscape that we can see coming up in India. Now, as Dev mentioned, the auto team at Invest India has been actively working in the electric vehicle cell space, particularly in the last 6 months since the launch of the production-linked incentive scheme for advanced chemistry cells. I'm sure everybody is aware of it, so I won't elaborate on that. But during this time, we have had the chance to interact with a lot of battery technology companies who are planning to enter India, and also a lot of domestic companies who are planning to diversify into this space, as well as companies who are already in this space. So it's fair to say that the EV battery market is developing and evolving alongside the development of the EV sector. They obviously go hand in hand. While there is a lot of research and development happening in various technologies in India, whether it's silicon, whether it's sulfur, or whether it's sodium ion, it's safe to say that lithium ion batteries are dominating the market and will continue to dominate the market globally as well as domestically. Now, most of the companies that we have interacted with who are planning to set up gigafactories are setting up in the pure play lithium ion battery space. since that technology, as we know, is tested and proven globally and is the most reliable technology as of date. Other technologies, if you say sodium and sulfur, will definitely enter the manufacturing arena, but those will be at a smaller scale, at least for the foreseeable future. So from a PLI ACC perspective, these batteries will be relevant in the niche technologies segment. Now, the real question is what materials will be predominantly used in the cathode of these lithium ion batteries. The two standard technologies that we know are NMC and LFP. So if I take the case of what's happening globally, a twofold approach is being followed, say by companies that we all know like Tesla and Volkswagen, Stellantis, etc. One is that for high performance vehicles, even higher performance electric two-wheelers, NMC batteries are being, NMC chemistry batteries are being used. And that's because they provide a higher cycle life and a higher energy density. However, the case with nickel and cobalt is that the price volatility is high. And these materials, like they've just mentioned, they are not prevalent in India. The second bit is that when it comes to low cost and economy vehicles, as well as stationary applications, captive demand, companies are preferring and shifting to LFP, considering the cost of these materials is, cost parity is there, materials is lower. And these materials are abundantly available. They are also low maintenance batteries. So when it comes to India, the EV market is dominated by two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And as we can see in the coming future as well, expansion is going to be happening in this space only, in these two segments at the moment. They are what we expect. They are going to form the base of the growth of the EV sector. So seeing this scenario, we feel that the LFP batteries will work very well for the Indian market, because barring lithium, all materials are abundantly present in India. So localization is going to become easier in that case. We'll have to obviously import lithium to some extent, but that won't be more than 5 to 7% of the battery value. Now the technologies, now we have interacted with several technology companies. We say out of a survey of 10 technology companies over 4 to 5 countries, the technologies that are bought in by major foreign battery tech players are will be bought by them itself. And the Indian manufacturing companies are obviously going to be currently dependent on these players for the tech bit. Now, over half of these companies are planning to bring in a nickel and cobalt free technology. These will include LFP as well as manganese iron based technologies. One point to note over here is that India is very rich in manganese. Over 8% of the world's reserves in manganese are in India. So chemistry that is nickel and cobalt free, but rich in manganese, is a great bet for India. A Norwegian battery player, battery tech company that we are interacting with, is planning to bring this technology in India. As long as it gives a decent cycle life and has a fair amount of energy density, that should obviously show during the testing phase, it will work well for India. And then other chemistries would also include LMP or metal polymer, and obviously the standard chemistry of LFP and NMC. Other than nickel, cobalt, and lithium, I think India has an abundance of most of the required materials. So this is from the battery tech perspective. Now, from the Indian manufacturing perspective, we have also spoken to almost all of the prospective bidders from a PLI ACC perspective. And most of these bidders are across sectors of energy, oil and gas, and auto. So players who are within the oil and gas and energy sectors will be focusing on LFP chemistries or nickel and cobalt free chemistries, because their batteries will be mostly used in stationary applications. So they won't require a high energy density, and they'll also need low maintenance batteries. When it comes to auto players, auto manufacturing players, in terms of EVs, they are split between LFP and NMC. Now, an auto player who is planning to manufacture and export high performance vehicles, they will be focusing on NMC chemistries, considering they have a higher energy density. So yeah, in conclusion, I would just say that in at least for the electric vehicle market, since we will see most of the traction happening in the two-wheeler space, LFP and NMC both have a good chance of dominating basis the performance of the vehicle. And we're also going to see some exciting new technologies in the future. Back to you, Dr. Praveen.
Thanks, Arshna. Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Sorry, due to some technical reason, I was not able to unmute. So, Mr. Dev, you have touched upon a very important point of this criticality of raw material supply vulnerability and the safety issues you have touched upon. And these are very, no doubt, these are very important issues. So for safety, like in the beginning when the we saw the presentation from Sikha, she was talking about the role of regulation and standards, regulations in for the EV and battery market. What do you think the role of regulation and standards in ensuring the battery safety and durability in Indian EV battery market? Because currently, as you mentioned there, we saw that a lot of fire accident in the two-wheelers, and this is mainly due to the poor thermal management and the low quality cells used in these batteries. This is as per the what we saw in the newspaper and other public domain. So what do you think the role of regulation and standards to ensure the durability and safety in these batteries?
Right. So, Dr. Praveen, definitely regulations do play a very critical role in the beginning phase of any industry when it's scaling up. So until we have that critical mass, regulations definitely play a very, very major role. So if you look at, I mean, just look at the Indian batteries which are being imported right now. On an average, the kind of energy density we have is about 84, 85 watt hour per kg, vis-a-vis a Chinese average of maybe 2.5x, 3x of this number. On the cycle life, again, the kind of average numbers we have are about less than 1500 cycles on an average, which are going in Indian vehicles, two wheelers in particular, vis-a-vis a Chinese average of 4000, 5000 plus. So right now, the point I'm trying to make is the kind of cells, the kind of batteries which are coming into India and going into Indian two wheelers are definitely not of the quality what we want. And that's happening because we do not have any standards, any regulations. It's basically a price conscious market, and what's happening is a lot of these batteries are regenerating very fast. Regeneration would mean that, I mean, they are basically degrading very, very fast, and the retention power of these batteries in terms of cycle life is again very less. Within a span of 2 years, the claimed cycle life is going below 80% in a span of 2 years. So until and unless we have proper regulations to ensure that A-grade cells or better quality cells are coming into the Indian market, these cheap imports will keep on happening because there is always a demand for lower price product in the Indian market. That's always going to happen. So with the PLI ACC scheme, which is coming up, it definitely is incentivizing only those manufacturers who are able to meet certain, who are able to meet certain performance parameters for their cells. For example, energy density needs to be above, let's say 180, 200 watt hour per kg. Energy density, again, it can be somewhere between 1000 to 10,000, but there is a matrix in which you need to fall, and basis your presence in that matrix, you will be incentivized, and this will change every quarter. So every quarter your testing will be done in the certified testing centers of Government of India, and basis your performance incentives will come. So this kind of localization will ensure that we have high performance cells which are being localized, because companies will be incentivized to make these high performance cells because they'll get subsidies only on these cells, and that's where we'll have slightly better quality vehicles and better quality batteries coming out of Indian market, which will eventually ensure safety of the Indian market, because these kind of fire incidences definitely spoil the entire morale of the industry and of the end consumer. It's not something which goes well. So it's important for us from a regulation standpoint to build certain standards, build certain minimum qualification parameters for these batteries, and that's how the industry will eventually scale up.
Yeah, because temperature is one of the critical thing for the lithium batteries, because they perform well between the range of 15 and 35. And right. If you're going beyond that, then the battery degradation goes on the higher side, and you just start losing the cycle life, what is promised at the beginning. Right. So their thermal management and BMS definitely is going to play an important role, and innovation. So now I'll go to once again to Ms. Arishna, and you mentioned about the technology, the kind of technology is going to dominate the EV market, and rightly you mentioned that LFP and NMC market is battery technologies are dominating the market. But and we have recently saw that Tesla is moving from NCA battery to LFP battery. But in the last 1 year, we have seen a lot of discussion around the aluminium air battery, and we saw the collaboration between Indian Oil Corporation and Finergy to develop the aluminium air battery for EV application, and even they have tested this battery in some of the vehicles in India. So what future you see for this aluminium air battery? Because it become very critical, as Mr. Dev mentioned, about the challenge associated with the raw material and the other things. So diversification of resources and also the diversification of battery technology becomes critical. So what role you see for the future you see for the aluminium air battery in Indian EV market?
Yeah, so personally, I am not very aware of the aluminium air technology. Yeah, I heard about it, that, you know, it's been tested on some Indian electric vehicles. The thing is that testing on a small scale and testing on a global scale, there's a huge difference. There are many, many technologies which have come in. And similar to aluminium, sodium has also been very successful in some countries. But at the moment, when we have interacted with big players who are willing, so it's a very capex intensive play, battery manufacturing. So for any big player, at least for any big Indian player to invest so much, they would only do so in case a battery has been tested for many years, not just on a few vehicles at least. So for aluminium to come into play, I would say further testing would be required. I don't see it coming in the next 1 year or 2 year, or coming in the PLI scheme for that matter. I feel that PLI scheme would be a play of pure play of LFP and NMC. And I'm only talking about pure LFP, even maybe a few variations in the LFP technology, like we mentioned, using manganese. But aluminium is not something basis our discussion with Indian players as well as battery technology companies that I feel would see a very successful future, at least in the first 1 or 2 years, or at a large scale. At a small scale, obviously, but at a large scale, I'm not too sure.
And just
thank you.
I'll just take 2 minutes, Dr. Praveen, just to add on to what Arishna just now mentioned. Definitely, there are a lot of global chemistries which are being developed, silicon-based batteries, sulfur batteries, aluminium air, all of these ones, sodium ion by CATL recently. So aluminium air, IOCL has made great progress in that direction, but still there are challenges on the recharging bit for aluminium air batteries. And having said this, the PLI ACC, which is coming up, it's mostly for the conventional lithium ion batteries, which are proven on a giga scale, as Arishna mentioned. So for the other batteries, which we just now spoke, silicon based or solid state or so on and so forth, these sort of batteries can definitely participate. These technologies can participate in the niche ACC program, which will come up in the coming months, which is worth 5 gigawatt hours. And this is specifically for battery technologies, which are not yet proven on a giga scale, but they do have the potential to go giga scale in the coming future, in the next 5, 10, 15 years. So technologies, niche technologies such as these ones, can definitely participate in the subsequent PLI ACC for niche technologies. But at present, the RFP, which has been launched on 22nd of October, it's primarily for conventional lithium ion batteries, which we already have more than 200 gigawatt hours operational worldwide, which is a proven sort of a NMC, LFP, BMLMP sort of technologies. This is what our take is on PLI.
Thank you, Mr. Dev and Arishna. You have shared very good points and very important points with the all the participants and panelists. Now I'll just go to Mr. Gerald. And I have 2 questions for you, and these are very important questions. One on the demand supply dynamics. So how you see the growing demand of EVs in India is going to impact this supply demand dynamics of EV batteries market? And the other question I have about this impact of falling battery price on the economic viability of EVs. So whether this falling trend in chemistry in battery price is going to help in addressing the issue of high upfront cost.
Okay, first, good afternoon and a pleasure to be with all of you. Good to see you, Dr. Pravin. It's always a pleasure to be with you. I must say that first, I'm not a specialist in batteries. I focus more on the e-mobility side from a demand perspective. As the World Bank, we have been working with NITI Aayog as part of their transformative mobility and battery storage program, both actually on the battery storage for renewable energy as well as the transformative mobility, because the two are going to work in symbiosis. And as part of this, we conducted the four studies that will help me answer Dr. Pravin's questions on how to accelerate the implementation of e-mobility in India, which was published in April. Then three studies that are about to be issued, one on the e-mobility market assessment, looking at different market segments. One looking at the bankability of electric buses and their the procurement of e-bus services. And the last one looking at de-risking e-mobility for two-wheelers and three-wheelers, because we see access to financing as one of the big bottleneck. Now, to start with, I would like to say that when we look at the e-mobility market globally, and in India more specifically, we are clearly at the beginning of a very steep inflection curve at this point. There is by now no real doubt that we are entering the decade of mobility, and all countries are moving at a pace that is very, very noticeable at this point in terms of bringing new model and the like. As such, you know, any forecast is bound to be incorrect in many ways. And if we look back relatively recent forecasts, IESA was looking at about 100 gigawatt hour per annum by 2032. You know, CEW is looking at 158 gigawatt hour of battery storage for EV by 2030 to meet the domestic market. There are other estimates out there, and I will just share our estimates as well. But what is really quite critical is that this is a global market, and beyond the domestic market, which is likely to become quite large very rapidly and for which you need capacity, beyond that, there is a large global market that can be tapped. And that's an opportunity for India to think of in terms of also future export. And that makes the scale of the market much, much bigger, obviously, than what would be purely for India. Now, what we have seen is that, obviously, the national program on ACC battery storage is going to be a big boost, and with 50 gigawatt hour of ACC battery coming out of this, or capacity coming out of this, will be addressing more or less actually what we are looking at as the upcoming demand. But what is important is when we look at the a lot of the estimates that were put on the table, we saw that a lot of them were more targets than based on price evolution. So we stepped back and looked at the total cost of ownership across market segment and tried to understand what would allow those markets to actually reach a level at which parity is achieved from a total cost of ownership perspective, and the market switch naturally to electric mobility. As was mentioned by some of the speakers earlier, the two-wheeler market and the three-wheeler markets are likely to be the first one to move forward, followed by passenger fleets. E-buses are likely also to come to the market relatively rapidly from a policy angle, first by public and state transport undertaking, and later on by the private operators who are looking at cutting down on fuel price. But if you just look at the pure price dynamic that is forecasted today in terms of falling price of batteries, etc., you're nowhere near reaching the target EV penetration share by 2030 that has been put in some of the national targets. I mean, on the pure economics perspective, you would get only about 17% penetration by 2030 when we run the number. However, what happens is that by looking at the type of regulations, policies that accelerate the uptake in the markets that are likely to be the first movers. So for example, two-wheelers as transport vehicle, accelerating the transfer to electric three-wheelers and by having easier registration, open permits and the like, opening up access to swappable batteries and the like, the price point drops to the point where the targets can then be more readily achieved. So what we have done is then factor in a number of recommendations at the national and state level that would then impact the market to understand what will happen. And with that, we find that overall, the market could reach a 35% penetration rate by FY30. With two-wheelers at 31%, two-wheeler personal at 31%, 46% for two-wheeler passengers and cargo, three-wheelers reaching about 50%, and the four-wheeler remaining at the 10 to 21%, depending on whether you look at passengers or fleet. Now, this translates in a demand of about 70 gigawatt hour, plus or minus, right? So plus or minus 10, depending on the dynamic associated with that. So the numbers are quite consistent with the new capacity that is being pursued by the program. So that's kind of the first question. We see that order of magnitude coming up, providing supporting legislation and regulations are put in place to accelerate those markets that are already reaching parity on the total cost of ownership perspective. As to your second question, you know, will the changing price trend of EV batteries soon fill the gap between EV and ICE vehicle price? I must say that compared to what ICCT presented, we are looking at it a bit differently. We are looking at it from a total cost of ownership rather than the upfront cost. Because when you look at, you know, an EV, essentially, the battery is like a prepayment of your energy cost. You're trading off, you know, a slightly higher capex upfront for a much lower opex as you run the vehicle over time. So the comparison is on total cost of ownership rather than over the life of the assets, rather than the upfront cost in what we have done so far. What is interesting, obviously, is the more you have a capex intensive vehicle, the more the utilization of this vehicle plays a role in making it affordable. So that's why fleets are likely to be the most early uptakers of electric vehicle. Now, a battery does represent a large percentage of the cost of 2-, 3-, 4-wheelers, you know, 40 to 60% typically. For buses, it's down to about 30% in the latest tenders we reviewed. But what is important to understand is that that relationship between the ICE vehicle and the E vehicle is both relative and dynamic. You know, petrol price in July 2019 were like 73 rupees. And, you know, by July 2021, they are 100 rupees. So what was making sense in 2019 doesn't make sense anymore in 2021 from staying with an ICE vehicle. And the same happens with diesel. So that dynamic is very critical to understand how the people and how people will transfer rapidly. The second part is that the energy charging cost is still not fully established in all locations. And I mean by that, not only the tariff, but the tariff plus the charges associated with providing the facilities. So that part plays a big role in the eagerness of a market to move to EVs. The third point that has been covered very well by ICCT is a rapid drop in battery costs globally, but also as the market in India scales up, the expected alignment with those global trends. I didn't hear much about solid-state batteries, but I think when you look at the 2030 agenda, it's likely to become important. So I just want to then come to the point of, when deciding whether or not to shift from a ICE to an EV vehicle, the price is only one parameter. The dependable life of a battery, the remaining value of a battery over 3-4 years, I mean, very much in line with the quality comments that were made before, is as important as the price point. Because when financiers decide, okay, I'm going to finance your 2- or 3-wheeler, if they cannot count on more than 1500 cycle, it creates a very big risk. So you can't secure the financing, you can't convert this upfront cost into a cost that spread over the lifetime value. So, you know, in conclusion, yes, we see that that alignment is taking place. Actually, on the TCO basis, 2-, 3-wheelers are now at parity or close to parity. e-buses are expected within the next 3-5 years, depending on the application. So let me conclude at that.
So thank you, Mr. Jiral, for sharing this important points with us. And Mr. Deepthi, we are running late on this. Already we are left with only 3-4 minutes. So you have seen, we have seen that comments from all our experts about the key topic. So it will be great if you can just give a quick comment on this topic based on the whatever we have heard about from our experts. 1 or 2 minutes if you can just. I think you're mute. Please unmute yourself.
Thank you, Dr. Praveen. And firstly, I thank you, everybody, to have me on board. It's very interesting to see all these points and comments, especially the presentation from Shikha. It was quite enriching, and the speeches by Dev and Arishna were very nice. I am a lawyer, and I advise a lot of companies on EV and battery, and having advised the Niti Aayog and helped the Government of India and DHI draft the PLI scheme, I myself drafted the entire scheme along with, of course, my teammates. I can tell that initially the transition from what will constitute battery to the definition of ACC, I can tell you that there is a huge paradigm shift, and what you see in the genericness of this definition is perhaps emanating from what Arishna mentioned, that there are so many different types of chemicals and compounds which are going to lead, but of course right now lithium ion is perhaps going to rule because of various factors. But having said that, I will like to point out one thing, because this is something that I witness in terms of questions from a lot of my EV and battery clients, large companies in India or abroad who are trying to take benefit of the PLI scheme. I think some of them that they've also mentioned, and so did Arishna. Is that there are a few players who are into battery technology only. One of them is actually my client, so being Log9, and the PLI scheme that has been developed, I think that is not very specifically discussing about how the benefits of demand incentives can go to somebody who is really doing battery, and for that purpose the FAME subsidies can go across to them. Of course, if somebody is building in as large as a gigawatt factory and trying to take benefit under the PLI scheme, of course that is different. But the reason why I pointed this out is there are some mechanisms under which even this can be handled. Battery companies can actually take benefit of the FAME policy as well, and that is very crucial, because as we know that right now it is largely the two-wheeler, three-wheeler, four-wheeler market which is trying to take benefit of these policies ultimately, and sales, the driving factor sales, is actually the pricing factor of the vehicle, which ultimately boils down to the battery, because that is close to 40-50% of the cost, right? Which is why it is very important to understand that once you are ready to manufacture, or once you're ready with the chemistry for the cells, I think it is very important to make sure that you are aligned with these schemes, as well as the benefits of FAME. And these mechanisms,
definitely incentives and this supply side and demand side is going to play a very important role.
Yes,
and we want to listen more, but time is not permitting us to go more on the details.
So let me do one thing. Yes, I appreciate, of course, that the time is short for all of us. But if anybody has any questions or doubts, please feel free to reach out to me either on LinkedIn or email, etc. And I would love to answer them.
So thank you, Mr. Deepthi, for sharing your viewpoint. And due to time constraint, we are not able to ask so many questions we have with us. So now over to you, Pallav.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much to all of our esteemed panelists, and a very special thanks to Dr. Parveen and, of course, Dev sir for managing the discussion superbly. It was a pleasure having you in such a well-planned and high-energy panel discussion. We just wish that we could have some more time, you know, to extend, or we could manage it in the time frame. So, can you hear a round of applause from the audience? Of course, it is virtual. I am sure if this would have been a physical event, we could have gotten a standing ovation for this amazing panel. Thank you once again, all of you. Okay, but the show is not over yet. We are taking a short networking break, and we'll be back with another exciting presentation and panel discussion session after this. After a short while, we'll be meeting around, you know, next at 15 minutes. Till then, explore our exhibition lounge network with your peers and join our sponsors on the networking table. Thank you. See you soon.
Welcome back, attendees. Without much delay, let's begin the session with the technoconferential presentation from our platinum partner, Advanced Technique Private Limited, and to present we have with us Mr. Tushar Gupta, Business Secretary. Tushar, sir, I welcome you on stage, and you can present your presentation.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everybody. So, as Hemant said, I'm the head of Epsilon Advanced Materials. And I'll be presenting. I'm doing a short presentation. Hold on for a second. Let me share my slides. I hope everybody can see it. So I'll be talking more about the role that raw materials play in the battery ecosystem. I think you've been talking a lot more about downstream and OEMs and battery manufacturers today. And so now we're going to focus a little bit upstream in terms of how the raw materials play into the entire ecosystem. So very broadly, if you look at a very broad level, there are five stages through which you know, a cell manufacturing process goes through. And at a very broad level, stage one is mining. So we're talking about you know, the basic materials like lithium, cobalt, nickel, graphite, which go into a battery cell. Stage two is chemical processing or even thermal processing, like in our case, of these metals. And then the anode and cathode production, which are extremely important elements of a cell, and that goes into cell manufacturing, and finally the application. So today I'm going to focus on stage two and three specifically, and go a little bit in more detail about that. But just to give you an idea, a lot of focus right now when we talk about shortage or availability issues is on the lithium metal. And actually, there is a shortage across. So if you look at either natural graphite, natural flake graphite, or cobalt, or nickel, in terms of the projections we have for cell manufacturing in the future, there is a big shortage. So there has to be a lot of investment flowing into capacities on the raw material side as well to meet the demand that will happen because of the increase in battery manufacturing that is expected over the next 10 years. So we're looking at 2030, and as you can see, the gaps are across all metal categories, basically.
Hello. Yeah.
If you go to the next slide, so who's producing what right now? So if you look at the five stages we spoke about, and as you can see across all the five stages, China kind of dominates. Countries in Europe and the US are also part of the. I think it's a little bit cool. Part of the stages, but clearly China is dominating across all the stages. And it's not only in the mining part of it, but also in the chemical processing part of it, the cathode and anode production as well as cell manufacturing. It's predominantly China. The raw material though is available across. So if you look at metal, for example, Australia, Indonesia, and major
Can anybody, everyone else can mute their mic so that they can talk.
Okay. Okay, sorry. Yeah, there was a little bit of an echo. Thank you so much for that. And so while mine reserves are spread across the world, for example, nickel, Indonesia and Australia has huge reserves. Of course, in Africa, cobalt and also graphite and lithium to a large extent. But still, a large part of the processing, and it's, for example, in graphite, 100%, almost 100% of the processing part of the chain is still in China. So China dominates right now as of today, and this is 2019, predominantly 2020-21 is a similar kind of a stage where China is dominating. And even if you look at the future, so just to give you an idea, where are all the capacities coming up on the raw material side? And it's all coming up, for example, let's take an example of graphite. Most of the capacities in terms of both in terms of processing specifically are coming up in China. So you know, whatever has been announced, whatever is planned, so even if you look in the future, 75% of the new capacities for graphite processing, for example, will be in China. Even though countries like Europe and the US are coming up, and in India as well, where Epsilon is part of that that increase in capacity, China will dominate basically. And also the fact, just to give you an idea about the time it takes for these capacities to come on board. It's not, you know, it's we're talking about, for example, in mining, we're talking about almost 8 to 25 years to set up a mine and to commercially start mining. Chemical processing, we're talking about 3 to 5 years. Anode cathode production is, which we are going through right now, Epsilon, is 2 to 3 years. And in fact, the cell manufacturing part of it is actually the, in terms of timeline, is actually the shortest part in terms of setting up the in as part of the value chain. So clearly, not only are we behind in terms of the capacities, the time it takes to set up these capacities on the upstream part of it is long, and so we need to start setting them up now. And so this is the point we're trying to make, where we're saying that India can also become a quite a big hub for chemical processing. Like China dominates right now, India has an opportunity to get into this part of the value chain and become a hub for chemical processing, especially the processing part in the lithium ion ecosystem. Just to give you an idea about the cost side of it, around 40% of a cell production cost is actually material cost, which is anode and cathode basically. And around 18% of the total cost is energy. So it's very energy intensive. And the good news is, as we know, India is focusing a lot on renewable power as a source of energy. And approximately 44% of the total energy requirements of India are going to come from renewable power. And we can take advantage of that to specifically come up with alternatives, especially for countries like China, where we use, we have a lower carbon footprint and lower carbon emissions when we set up this hub for processing of battery materials, raw materials. So I think there's a great opportunity there. And of course, there are some incentives from the government, which has also been happening through the PLI scheme for ACC. A similar kind of incentive scheme would help to get that jump start in terms of setting up these processing facilities. So that was a little bit about, just to give you context of how the raw materials or upstream part plays in the value chain of manufacturing, cell manufacturing, and a little bit about Epsilon Carbon and where we are today. So Epsilon Carbon is basically, we are a carbon product company where we use coal tar, essentially coal tar to manufacture products. We have three categories. Of products that we're manufacturing today. This is specialty carbon part of the business, which is our core business. We have recently moved into carbon black also, and we have quite a large capacity set up for that. And now we're moving into advanced carbon materials, which is essentially to start off anode materials for the lithium-ion battery manufacturers. And today, we are already in qualification process with some of the largest battery manufacturers globally. So we're not looking at only India as a market, we are looking at global manufacturers as an alternative to other countries. And so we're talking about some of the big names here. I'm sure most of you know these big names, so I won't go into details. So that is a mix of European, East Asian, and American companies, including India as well. One of our biggest advantages of Epsilon is our access to raw materials. So Epsilon is, our facilities are part of one of the largest integrated steel complex, JSW, in the south of India and in Karnataka. And we form part of that integrated complex. So we have coal tar readily available, low logistics costs because we are part of the complex. And we have a lot of synergies across which we use to bring down our cost of manufacturing, which makes us cost competitive, especially against larger processing company and our material manufacturing companies, especially in China. And we have very aggressive plans. So as you saw, we were making around 2,500 tons of anode materials today. We plan to be close to 15,000 in 2023. We're already setting up the plant for that. And by 2025, we will be close to 60,000 and then moving ahead to 2030, 275,000. It's a combination of synthetic graphite, natural graphite, and also a composite graphite with a silicon blend as well. So what are our advantages or differentiation points compared to our competitors? The main thing is our technological know-how. We have a patented technology for the processing part, which is thermal based. As I said earlier, we have an end-to-end solution in the sense that we have access to raw material. We make our own coke, and finally, we use that to make synthetic graphite and also process natural graphite as well. We have the ability to do blends of natural and synthetic graphite. As I said, we have long-term raw material contracts. That's something very different from the other competitors who rely on buying coke, needle coke from the market, either on the spot basis or long-term basis, which we don't have to because we have access to coal tar and make our own coke. Also, on the natural graphite side, we have contracts with Indian graphite flake manufacturers, and I'll talk a little bit more about some of the joint ventures we're entering into with graphite miners across the world. And finally, the most important part is the carbon CO2 emissions and the environment-friendly operations that we have. We are ESG compliant, a zero discharge facility, and as we set up a graphitization plant, a large part of the power used will be coming from renewable sources. So that's something which gives us differentiation against our competitors as well. Just to give you an idea of the kind of joint ventures and strategic alliances we are getting into, this is an example of one of the MOUs that we signed recently for a joint venture with a natural graphite manufacturer in Finland of setting up a facility, actually a thermal processing facility to produce synthetic graphite or even natural graphite anodes in Finland. And this is an example of the kind of strategic alliances we are getting into. And you will hear another announcement coming up soon, hopefully by next week, of a similar kind of alliance with a battery manufacturer. I think that's it from my side. I don't know whether it's stuck to the 15 minutes limit, Hemant.
Hey, so, yeah, you yes, did, sir. You did, Tushar. Fantastic.
Yes, sir, you were on time, sir.
Sorry?
So thank you, sir, for such a... So I was saying you were on time, sir. I was saying, sir, thank you, sir, for such a valuable insight. And I hope everyone must have learned something from this presentation. So it's time now for our second session. Let me see how many people are active with us. Can you hit the like button to show me... You can use the emoji. Show us the like button, thumbs up. Perfect. It's time to have a much awaited panel discussion for the session on EE OEM dialogue. In the esteemed panel, we have Mr. Rajiv Payasarsal. He's from EETO Motors. Mr. Dev Mukherjee from Omega Psi E-Mobility. Mr. Sameer Kumar Mishra from JBM Group. Mr. Tushar Gupta from Epsilon Advanced Materials Private Limited. Mr. Hujifa EC from Ashok. Mr. Manikandan P from Beer Electro. And Mr. Ujjwal Iyengar, he is a TV main expert. The discussion will be led by Rajiv sir. Welcome all panelists on the screen, and I'm handing over the session to Rajiv.
Hey Hemant. Hi Hemant. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Great. So all the participants, a very good evening. Thank you very much once again, Hemant and E-Mobility Plus for having me as a moderator. I'm myself Rajiv Vaisar. I take care of the sales, business development, marketing and PR on behalf of EETO Motors. EETO Motors is a 360-degree, I would say, ecosystem enabler from the electric mobility perspective. We are a combination of manufacturer, fleet operator and charging infrastructure developer. And I'm very, very happy here hosting some of my, I would say, friends from the industry who have been contributing really well to the growth of electric mobility, I would say, ecosystem. So without much ado, let me quickly introduce all of them. And this is the pattern we are going to go. As I call upon the members, I request them to introduce about themselves and their organization and what they've been doing, probably in a time frame of say 90 seconds, and then we will immediately enter into the panel discussion, right? Maybe we can start with Mr. Huzaifa from the Ashok Leyland company.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I think I have a technical problem as usual with my video. So good to be here on this platform. Thank you for hosting me. Been with Ashok Leyland for a long time, 2 decades now. I lead the electrification pursuits of Ashok Leyland, which caters to both buses and LCVs. Look forward to the session. Thank you, Rajiv.
Hey, thank you, Zepa. And yeah, Mr. Dev Mukherjee from Omega Psi.
Yeah, thank you, Rajiv. Thank you very much for having me on this panel. It's always a pleasure interacting with the fellow professionals from the industry. I'm Dev Mukherjee, and I am from Omega Psi Private Limited. We manufacture electric vehicles, two, three-wheelers, and we are also a full mobility solution provider. We run our own last-mile fleets as well. So I'm really looking forward to this session. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sameer Kumar Mishra from JBM Group.
Hi. First of all, thank you, E-Mobility Plus, giving the opportunity, and it is a wonderful opportunity to speak to the August audience. So I am Sameer. I am working in JBM as a Chief Technology Officer, and I joined recently, but the e-mobility domain experience is almost around 7 years, where from Sun Mobility, I have developed the technology right from the scratch with millions of kilometers under the belt. And at JBM, I am taking care of the complete EV domain technology, and we are mostly working on the e-bus right now. And we have rolled out almost 700 electric bus on the road, and some are in pipeline. And soon we'll be venturing into the other domains of the mobility sectors.
Fantastic, Mr. Ujjwal. Thank you very much, Mr. Sameer. Ujjwal.
Hello. Good evening, gentlemen, a great audience and a very distinguished panel. This is Ujjwal here. I have close to about 2 decades of automotive experience, of which the last 12 years have been into core EVs. So I've been into concepts, designs, development, implementations with both traditional organizations, as well as I've also been in advisory capacities with close to 6 startups in India.
Great, Ujjwal, nice to have you here. And Mr. Manikandan.
See, very good evening, everyone. I think most of the known people are also here. Me and Bijwal work together for some time. Yeah, so I've been in the industry for quite some time. I've been working with Robert Bosch for 20 years, after which the first part I've spent on ICE powertrain, and the second part was in electric powertrain. So I'm one of the earliest starter in electric mobility technology. I started as early as 2007 when I started the first electric powertrain component development engineering setup for Bosch in India. So that is how my journey into electric started. And see, I've been post my Bosch era, I was working with Ola for some time. I was building this powertrain for the Ola electric scooter that is getting launched. Now I'm with Hero Group as a chief technology officer. And more than, let's say, 14, 15 years of knowledge I have in this e-mobility field, I would say. So that's what I'm going to share with you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Manikandan. And anyway, Mr. Dushar has already introduced himself to the good presentation. So so let's get in. I think, well, this particular topic has been a topic of interest to me, because batteries, right, most of us know that they form the heart of the vehicle. They kind of contribute close to half of the vehicle's cost, etc. But, and of course, they have been coming down in their prices for the past few years. But for the recent crisis and then the recent supply chain hurdles that the industry at this point of time is, I would say, witnessing or expressing. Now, I would like to take this first question to Mr. Sameer, right? What do you think, Mr. Sameer, are the key challenges for Indian OEMs in terms of stabilizing manufacturing and optimizing cost, but still unable, while doing this, how is it possible to meet the expectations of the customers? Your couple of few cents, please.
Thank you very much. And this is very key challenges. This is not only for JVM, this is for every OEM in India right now in facing. So let me start with the recent power shortage in the China, and it created a havoc. The manufacturing has been affected there, and the manufacturing has been affected in India. So that means I can say indirectly, it is a little bit sarcastic, but indirectly it is the fact that depending upon the China's movement, we are manufacturing. So we don't have the own source of materials, own source of the components. Only when China or the other countries which are initiating the proper supply chain, maintaining the requirement, fulfilling our demand, then we are able to cope with the production demand, whatever it is there. Then the another thing is, everybody might be hearing right now, the race for the gigafactory around the globe. So everybody is, no one is talking less than 30 gigawatt, 40 gigawatt, 200. Tesla is talking in hundreds gigawatt. So like the race is going on, the SKI, Ford, GM, everybody. So the way it is going, the pool for the material and the supply chain will be further constrained in next 5 to 10 years, and definitely somewhere it will come as a point that India will be neglected actually in terms of the supply chain. The reason is the recent scenario when there is a power shortage, all those things is seen in China. So to keep the demand intact for the European and American suppliers, Chinese suppliers did the smart work. They increased the volume demand from the European and American companies, and with overprice they have supplied to them, and they have denied to India. So that is the recent news. So impact is there, everybody. All OEMs impact is there. The COVID is a artificial thing, but actually the real thing is the creation of the problem creation in the demand is by artificial way by China, citing that the demand is not there, volume demand is not there.
Thank you, Mr. Sameer. I think you touched upon an interesting, I would not call it completely controversial, but a very interesting statement, whether this particular crunch right now we are facing is artificial or is it natural. While I leave that particular discernment to the audience to think, first of all, Mr. Dev Mukherjee, congratulations on launching your first LCV in Indian market, right? And now I just want to understand from you, how do you look at the future of EV batteries in India, and can we really consider talking about manufacturing cells also in India, not just importing those cells but at assembling, but can we consider manufacturing those cells? If at all we were to consider manufacturing these cells, I'm sure then definitely we'll be quoted. But do you see, as a leading one of the leading OEM manufacturers, do you see such kind of a thing exists, and is it possible for us to even envision that thing in India? Please.
Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you very much. You have raised a very pertinent, very important question a point for discussion. You see, EV, everybody knows, I think the debate of whether EV is coming or not is settled. Now the alternate fuel technology is going to be there, and battery technology is right at the forefront. Tomorrow, I don't know, maybe hydrogen will come or some other fuels will come. But today it is very much clear that battery driven vehicles are going to be the immediate future. In that context, as we see in India also, I firmly believe that next year onwards we would be reaching tipping point in some of the form factors like two wheelers and three wheelers, and particularly the commercial vehicles space. And there are various studies, research reports, data, etc., including the government Niti Aayog, etc., which are projecting electric vehicle conversion from anything from 40% to even 80% by 2030. Now that's a bit ambitious, given that we don't have a clear supply chain in place, and we are largely importing the cells and making the battery modules and packs, etc. And in many cases, a lot of these low-end, cheap, and maybe even life-expired batteries are landing here, and there are safety issues among other issues. So, to answer your question directly, yes, I do see a very encouraging sign in terms of the supply chain setup in place. The factors in favor are the government subsidy, government sustained government push. Now there the PLI scheme is already out, the advanced cell chemistry, government has invited bids for 18,000 crores, etc. So I am very sure the big companies, Reliance, Adani, Tata, etc., the big business groups are definitely going to pitch in. And we are going to see at least, somewhere around 20 to 30 gigawatt capacity in next 5 years. That's my belief. But I would raise an important point that is probably not a long-term solution unless you yes. have the full supply chain of raw materials in place. And this is where China will always be ahead of us, because they have secured a huge amount of mining rights, extraction, mm-hmm. and refining. 90% of these materials get refined in China. And a Bloomberg study shows that the many of these materials travel as much as 50,000 miles, all the way around the globe to get refined, then get made, turned into cells, and then eventually in the batteries, and then they land up in the vehicle. So I think we need to see, are we able to do that? Are we thinking on that? And probably somebody like Reliance can come up with their refining capacity, for example, and what they did in petroleum, setting up the world's largest refinery. Then we will have a full control on the supply chain. Materials, of course, many of these materials are not available in India. You can't do much about it. But, having access to these materials can be done. But the whole refining, then you have to go through hundreds of stages of before it becomes a cell. I think the whole control looks difficult, but it will take a long time, maybe a few decades, for us to get to strengthen the supply chain. But the first steps are in place. I do see that the PLI will encourage the battery cell manufacturing. Pack manufacturing with the the robust technology of whether laser welding or battery cell testing, cell balancing, etc. need to be in place so that we are sure of the safety of the battery, the life of the battery, the performance over the life cycle performance, etc., must be ensured by robust processes. That's my view. I think it's going to take time, but I think the first steps are we do see right steps in place.
Thank you, Mr. Deb. And interestingly, already the world is divided in terms of the charging infrastructure, right? The world is divided already, saying that, okay, Tesla goes there on Super Tesla, and we have CCS, we have CHAdeMO, we have GB-MIT, and now we are talking about our own path standards, correct? Now, this is already, I say, a problem which the government and then the Department of Science and Technology is trying to address. How do they bring the standardization and interoperability in the charging infra? But then now the interesting point is, not just at the charging infrastructure, even at the battery levels, there is already a segregation, right? So my next question would be to Mr. Manikandan, right? Mr. Manikandan, how do you think a collaborative approach can help between the OEMs and battery manufacturers, especially in the context of standardization and interoperability? Because when it happens, really, then the volumes will increase, then right, the numbers go up, the cost will come down, the parity comes into picture. There is no longer an apple to orange, but apple to apple comparison, and we definitely have better life and better air to breathe. To you, Mr. Manikandan, please.
Yeah, you have touched a very, very, very important point of the whole electric mobility ecosystem. So when Samir was talking about the supply ecosystem, and they was talking about how the batteries can be improved, the systems, the sourcing, and more than anything else. So what we have to look at India as a country is standardization, right? We don't have a standardization panel established as such. For all the EV company, not only battery, charger, the kind of protocols that is used for charging, the charging, handles, guns, and the infrastructure standards, and the battery standards, and the voltage level. For example, the voltage levels for a two-wheeler, and two-wheeler itself, there are subdivisions. And anybody, yes. Tomorrow, you have some voltage level, then you can plan one vehicle in that voltage, right? And between the voltage level, how do the scalability, right? How do we scale? Lots and lots of system standardization should happen, and they have to form a standardization committee, probably led by people like ARAI, RBIS. They have to come together first of all. OEM coming probably the next step. So ARAI, Niti Aayog and BIS. And they have to come together, and they have to see. I would expect or request that they have to set that the norms by which the compliance should meet. And the next level, probably the OEMs and the manufacturers can also, kind of give some ideas, as I said, and kind of form a forum or consortium, to be very precise. These consortiums can come out with some ideas, because in other countries, the OEMs have come together and they form consortium. You talked about CHAdeMO. You talked about CCS, right? Where it all came from? It came from the consortium formed by the OEM.
Yeah.
And also some standardization happened, eventually in Europe and UK. Where China, of course, they copied all the Euro standard, and they've copied, and then they made their improvement on that, and they called it GB parity, right?
Yeah.
So. And what is the India standard? Can we say that it's something equivalent to GB parity or something equivalent to that? So I sometimes surprised to, even at the leadership level in the country, talking about that everything can coexist. Maybe we create a system which works in all the environment. So
yeah,
it's an ho sakta, right? This is not, we have to see that what is our standard, which would work for us. Probably there's where the whole thing can start, and the component development capability, we are very, very far, behind. We have largely lost in the hardware, electronics area. So at least in electric mobility, we have an opportunity. The standardization definitely would help. If such things are happening, even I would also like to participate and contribute to whatever possible way. I think it's a very important point that we have to try. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Manikandan. In fact, just to add on to what you said, we must really, I would say, appreciate the the initiations and then the leading, I would say, step taken by Neeti Aayog, because never ever in the history that the country's highest think tank, right, the earlier planning commission or the current Neeti Aayog, right, took such a very aggressive, I would say, movement when it comes to electric mobility. And thanks to Mr. Amitabh Kant, and thanks to Mr. Sri Anil Srivastavji, who was the ex, I would say, e-mobility director. I think they have done a fantastic job, and the way Neeti Aayog anchored the whole thing. And now I also understand the Department of Science and Technology is working on some kind of a standardization to India. I think what you said is really right. While the OEMs can always come together, there should be some kind of a guidance factor, right, from ARAI and ICAT to come together along with these, I would say, other anchoring agencies, and then show some kind of a path or a way, right? Yeah. I think fantastic. Thank you very much, Mr. Manikantan. Now, this brings me to another important question, and this question I would like to ask Mr. Tushar, right? Now, this is what it is. While we are talking about standardization, while we are talking about interoperability and stuff like that, I somehow think that this is a very, very part of a strategy that the government has made, and it is coming out step by step, right? While on one hand, we are talking about interoperability and then the standardization. On the other hand, the government already passed a resolution of delinking the glider and the battery, which is one of the very, very, I would say, most ambitious and a very, I would say, dynamic and brave move, right? Because until then, there were so many questions. How do you delink them? How do you let go OEM of their liability of the battery and the vehicle? Who would be responsible when something happens? I mean, there are so many unanswered questions, but yet the government made it stand very clear that to get parity and to get the right price tag, we don't buy petrol along with the vehicle for lifetime. Why do we buy energy along with the vehicle for the lifetime? Right? A fantastic move, right? Now, I just want to understand from Mr. Tushar that, do you think this delinking battery out of EV is a welcome step? The reason why I'm asking if it is a welcome step is because of the recent incidences that we see, where some of the vehicles are kind of unfortunately caught on fires and things like that. So, will it increase such risks? Will it increase such occurrences? Just want to hear from you, Mr. Tushar.
No, but again, I think it's almost linked to what Mr. Mukherjee also mentioned. Ultimately, we are relying on, we're relying on essentially China. We're relying on imports of batteries, and the quality assurances around that, are suspect, basically. So until we have our own domestic cell manufacturing industry in place, it's difficult to control that. So I think delinking makes sense to that extent. Okay, the liability part of it, because cell is the most important component of an EV. I mean, if you're going ahead, if you look at that. So I think it's extremely important. But I'm a little bit more optimistic than Mr. Mukherjee in terms of, the capability of the Indian ecosystem to, so I'm going a little bit different from the topic, but I think it's important to talk about that also. In terms of capability of the Indian ecosystem to actually manufacture cells or batteries, and also develop the upstream part of it. Because, Epsilon, companies like Epsilon, our company is doing that right now. So there is a capability side of it. The second part is a lot of the, as I showed in my presentation also, a lot of the processing of the raw materials which go into a battery is being done in China. But countries in Europe and the US are trying to do that also. So it's not only about basically capturing the mineral side of it, the metal side of it, but also the processing side of it. So I think there's no reason why that can't be done in countries like India as well, because Europe is also creating those kind of capacities. And so I think that there's an opportunity there. And I think we have all the basics in place to do that. With the PLI, the ACC PLI scheme coming in, I think, and maybe hopefully that will go upstream as well. We can do that as well. So I think that it's linked to that, basically. If you rely on imports and you don't have any control over the standards of imports that are coming in, the delinking part of it is linked to that to a certain extent for us, basically. Because right now you're stuck essentially with imports from China in terms of the standard of the batteries that are coming in. And I also heard somewhere that there were some people talking about that some of the Chinese manufacturers might actually ask for the batteries to come back. So they supply the batteries, they will ask them to be returned back to China rather than going through the recycling route in India. I've been hearing some stories around that as well. So, you know, you control the recycled part of it as well. I mean, the second life as well, yes, to a large extent. So, I think insecurity is a problem. Yeah.
I think this is a very interesting point, Mr. Tushar, because I was reading in one of the articles on a concept called urban mining, right? The article argues that we have, I would say, millions and millions of mobile phones, okay? Now, the elements and then the materials are same, right? Why can't these lithium battery packs of these mobile phones can be re-mined, right? Recycled, right? I think, and that happens not in the mines outside the country, but then happens within the city, right? That's what the article talks about, urban mining, which is the next potential revolution or business opportunity to kill the anxiety in terms of batteries. I think that's a very interesting topic that you have brought in. Thank you very much. And at this point of time, let me go to Mr. Ujjwal Iyengar, who happens also to consult, to many startups, right? Now, my question is, Mr. Ujjwal, right? Assuming that you are consulting few OEMs, right? Now, what would be your expectations from the battery manufacturers? What would be your ask from battery manufacturers?
Thank you, Mr. Rajiv. Yeah, based on my experience that I have had with at least 6 to 8 OEMs now on the EV, you know, these people, they focus basically on 5 areas when they do a total vehicle. The first basic thing is the mechanical system, which is your brakes. This is something which is already established, and you know, people do have a backup in terms of a supply network that they can supply. But what becomes interesting for them is 4 areas. You know, basically the power electronics, the drivetrain, the connected system, and importantly, the power pack, or which is the battery that we are talking about. Now, in this case, you know, luckily enough for us in India, we have good amount of the IT bandwidth, because of which the connected and HMI, these are something that's easily available within the industry for us. But however, when you look at batteries, what becomes really complex is 5 things in it. You know, first basically is the cost, something that you talked about, wherein in an EV, almost between 40 to 60%, you know, depending on what kind of EV you are really looking at, from 2-wheeler, 3-wheeler to 4-wheeler, 40 to 60% of the cost is sitting in there. So that means to say that, you know, if you have to be competitive in the business world, this is your only prime area that you can attack. The amount of effort that you're going to put into this particular segment is what is going to give you the real outcome. The second is definitely in terms of the availability, which I think Mr. Tushar, Mr. Deb, you know, they have spent a lot in terms of, do we have enough resources? Can we make it in India? What does it take to make it in India? And are we really dependent on only one, the lithium family of batteries? Or can we look at different technologies in batteries, like going into metal layers, going into, you know, supercapacitors? So there are many still unexplored territories into this thing when you are looking at the availability from a battery perspective. The third is the usability. When I say usability, you know, again, this has a bit of an interlink with the cost, because today the amount of battery that I give defines the range of the vehicle. And, you know, for a consumer tomorrow who is going to buy an electric vehicle, for him, it's at the end of the day, just a vehicle. He expects that he has to go from point A to point B, be it electric, be it petrol, be it diesel, the purpose should be filled. But however, the moment you say electric, you know, the concern of range starts peeping in. So to an OEM, it becomes a very, you know, a dicey balance, saying that, should we give more battery? If I give you more battery, then automatically I'm going to increase my cost. Yes, I'm going to define your range. But however, the moment I start reducing on the battery front, the cost reduces, but the range
takes a hit. Range anxiety kicks in.
The range anxiety. You know, so this is a very dicey thing where OEMs really try to play. Now, in all this, the most important thing that comes is to really define the complexity that's involved in the battery. What, you know, my fellow panels, they have been discussing on more from the commercial aspect, but I just want to bring in a point of view from a technical perspective. You know, battery is just not a system which works like a mechanical linkage. You know, it has a combination of electrical, it's got a combination of mechanical, it's got, importantly, chemical, the chemistry behind it.
Chemistry behind it, yeah.
And chemistry is very, very difficult to estimate how it's going to behave. You know, given the temperatures, given how you charge it, how you discharge it, what happens, a couple of last incidences that we have seen, unfortunate enough, at very early stage in the EV thing, it's all because we are not really able to model how a battery is going to really work during its life. What I would really see is, I think in India, we do have a lot of startup ecosystem coming up. Fundings are really good at this point of time. And I think we should open ourselves to see how can we really look at different technologies within the battery that can help, you know, pull back into the OEMs. And I'm sure, you know, there are a huge amount of problem statements on the battery side. And if you're able to fill that, OEMs are going to give you a red carpet welcome for sure.
Superb. Thank you, Ujjwal. Now, this also brings me to a different context, right? I mean, especially you touched upon a point. What do I offer to the customers? Do I offer comfort by giving a bigger battery pack and then and charge them more? Or do I offer them an economical product by kind of letting them go through the range anxiety, right? Probably at this point of time, I want to understand the possibility of the swappability of the batteries, at least at two-wheeler levels and to a certain extent at three-wheeler levels, and their modular built and design, especially from the, I mean, can, again, irrespective of 2, 3, 4 wheelers, can we standardize all the battery packs into particular modules? And just that these number of modules only change as if at all we want to increase the kilowatt hour of the battery, right? Now, let me put this question to Mr. Huzaifa, right, from Ashok Leyland. So I want to understand from you, what do you think the Indian market or what approach the Indian OEMs take, especially in terms of the scalability and modular battery designs?
Yeah, thank you. I think very interesting question and also very pertinent from Indian OEM, because just like we have a lot of cultural backgrounds, I think we also have a need for different transportation solutions, right? So mobility solutions, right, from a bicycle till maybe I can say a truck or a bus, right? So I have a one slide. Will you allow me to present one slide on this subject?
Please go ahead.
Yeah. So I'm going to share my screen and let me know when you can see my screen, please. Is it seen now?
Yeah, it is. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So you look at this. You have a two-wheeler, a cycle, bicycle, which is electrifying for a very short commute, bike ride, LCV or auto, a bus, a car or a truck, right? On what are all depends? It depends on voltage. You might start at 12 volts, 24 volts, and goes up to 600, 800 volts in voltage capacities. And if you look at capacity wise in terms of kilowatt hour, you rightly mentioned, maybe a bike might need about 0.5 to 1 kilowatt hour, whereas a truck or a bus might need a 300 kilowatt hour battery pack on a system. So what happens? I have a, this is my thought process, how we could do this is whether you have a cylindrical cell or a pouch or a prismatic, you need to have one lithium ion module. It's like a Lego block. Now it is independent of what chemistry you use. LFP could be heavy but cheap. NCA and NMC could be again light, but maybe at a cost parity you might be having on equal. LTO again might be heavy but give you a lot of life. So the approach could be that can we have a Lego block that defines this module? And looking from a technical perspective, I have put into four buckets: a voltage, capacity, a physical dimension, and communication. If you are trying to break the crux of these four dimensions of a module, I think we have hit the bullseye. So let me talk to you about voltage. I'm proposing a 48 volt. Why? Because most hybrids to an electrified solutions are looking at an LCM, I say the least common multiplier, to get at 48 volts. So if we standardize this to 48 volts, you could get any other voltage by just seriesing them, right? So you add more modules to it and you get whatever voltage range you want. So now it starts sufficing all my mobility requirements. About kilowatt capacity, we said about 1 kilowatt or 300 kilowatt kilowatt hour. You might have a different module saying that it's a 48 volt 20H module or a 48 volt 30H module or a 48 volt or any other module. It could be standardized. And when you parallel them, you get the capacity that you want. So now you have an answer for voltage and a capacity that you can meet for all applications. Now come to the physical dimensions. Obviously, a 20H module will be different from a 30H module. And just extending that to other modules, you might have different length, width, and height for each of these modules. Now, this LBH is going to be critical based on our application. A height for a car could be okay, but could not be okay for a two-wheeler, or could be not okay for an LCV or a auto, three tricycle. So we need to manage that part of it. And also importantly, from mechanical perspective, what size of terminal connectors you should have, so that there's a standardization over that. And you also have a communication connector which is the same type and connection pinouts, so that they don't have any issues. On communication, because this has to be built like a Lego block, you should be having to talk to each other as a single module. You could have a slave BMS on each module, so you can talk to each other using a master BMS. And we should have a standardization of the canned messages as well, maybe even the IDs and what should be measured on voltage, current, temperature, which are basic requirements for any BMS, and plus the errors and warnings on both sides. What if there's an error warning from the vehicle to the battery and from the battery to the vehicle? So what is benefits? It's like a Lego block you have from the vehicle OEMs. If I am the guy, it would be helping me to create modular packs, a faster time to market, because I have Lego blocks which I can build in to get increase or decrease the capacity. So instead of saying plug and play, I would say it's connect and drive. From the battery manufacturers, now they're standard modules. So the battery manufacturers will have less variants for the entire industry. They will have improved productivity and faster time to market. What about the fleet managers? I'm saying from that, because these are all the stakeholders. So they'll have a lower inventory cost, interoperability between suppliers, multi-brand cost. Like if you have a swap solution, you don't need to have a swap solution for XYZ, because now they are a modular. I can go to anyone and bring in. It's just like you filling up petrol or diesel in an HP or a Shell or a BP kiosk. And also it helps you to have a second life application for UPS and things like that. And to the last end customer, I have a flexibility to change supplier. I'm not happy with brand A because it's giving me better, poor life. I can go to brand B, buy it and put it on my vehicle. So this also touches upon the point that Indian regulations allow us to sell vehicles without a battery. So now the customer can use this because of interchangeability. So overall, this is what I wanted to share in two slides of how interoperability and replaceable ability could have been managed by doing a modular and a scalable battery.
Hi, Huzaifa. Let me first, I cannot stop clapping you. I think you brought it so brilliantly, you brought it so beautifully. And this is a very interesting thing, right? I mean, what if everything is into Lego box and as per the need of it, you kind of assemble them and bring the standardization. I think the solution is already here. Is it safe for us to assume that Ashok Leyland is something into this, Huzaifa?
I'm on the last part of this supply chain, right? So I am a victim of it rather than think so. But yeah, this is a food for thought for all of us, because that's why I mentioned all the four stakeholders. So started with me as an OEM, but also goes to down to battery and the last end customer for whom we are building these vehicles.
No wonder necessity is the mother of invention, and a lot of innovation starts from the pain points, right? I think fantastic, Huzaifa. Thank you very much for sharing. Now, at this point of time, let me talk about, I mean, this is a brilliant thing and I want to build the conversation on it to Mr. Samir Kumar Mishra, right? Now that he has also shown a way of, right, bringing standardization and, I mean, the at least the slides kind of made it really simple for me to assume that, wow, one of the biggest problems is already solved, right? I just want to understand at this point of time, are we inching towards an advancement of technology in the similar direction that we have, or are we inching towards advancement of technology in some other direction? So Mr. Samir Kumar, the question is to you, what are the recent advancements in battery technology for automotive applications, and where do you think this is inching towards?
So Huzaifa has presented almost equivalent to a standardization, I can say. That's a great thought process. So in standardization point of view in India, actually, we are inching towards the standardization in terms of one kind of cell right now, which is NCM and LFP. So this is right now there, but the other developments around the globe, like lithium, the solid electrolyte, the solid state batteries, the sodium ion battery, lithium sulfur, lithium air, lots of researches are going on. So those things which will be coming to volume production in millions of unit production, it will take a couple of years, maybe 3 to 5 years. But right now, whatever the availability, so beggar is not a chooser, you can say that. So whatever we have right now, the NCM and LFP, that you can consider as a standardized cells going around in almost all the manufacturers right now in India. But having said that, if that approach is there, the whatever Huzaifa has thought and whatever the way we are thinking going ahead to make at least the 20 to 30 gigawatt of battery requirement by 2025, then we have to have a standardization in one particular of cell or other particular of cell, so that across all OEM can build together as a consortia and have a cost optimized solutions. Everybody will benefit from that. So that is one point. The another point I will touch upon towards this standardization approach, where this we are talking about the result only the outcome. Standardization is the outcome. Who will do the standardization around the globe? Almost all these R&D houses are day in day out from past couple of years are engaged in research. So that is the R&D resource engaged there. India, the focus everywhere talking about the production linked incentives, the subsidy from the government, all those things, manufacturing subsidy, the supply chain actions, but nobody is bothered about the investment in the R&D from government side, from the policy side. The investment in the R&D, encouragement of the R&D and resources creation, the technology mind creation, no thought is there. And you know, once you start thinking that, and the effectiveness will take at least 10 years to come to the surface. So when we should keep on chasing continuously the outsiders who will develop some kind of cell, say sodium ion cell in 2024, it will be successful, then we will bring it to India, start using it. Should we be keeping waiting for the outside lab only? So that is what the requirement is. Even though there is a multiple technologies available everywhere, the researches are going on, we have to move in our own way also to give emphasis on the new technology development, and by that way we can move towards the standardization. When something will be developed in India, definitely it will be much cheaper than the outsiders development, because they will take the years of whatever investment in terms of the material, whatever they will supply, and that will be always costly to us.
Interesting. I think you have touched upon again another important aspect, right? When I evaluate and analyze most of the central level, I would say policies or state level EV policies, there is a lot of focus on the demand generation, definitely.
Yes.
There is a lot of focus on the supply creation, definitely. But like you rightly said, a very limited focus on creating the R&D, creating the know-how, creating the technology in-house. And for some reason, I think we Indians are very impatient, I would say, right? We really may not like to dig deeper and then develop something, but rather, right, if anything available in the world, pick it up and then just fit it and go it, right? I think that's what I think is the tendency. But yeah, as you rightly said, more and more research has to get into this technology. We need not necessarily be at the tail end of the, I would say, the developments. We should probably be the torchbearers. We should probably be the leaders, right? Who would lead this thing forward. Now my next question is to Mr. Ujwal, right? So Mr. Ujwal, the question is, while we are talking about all of these things and right again a lot of confidence issues on batteries and their efficiencies and right not just in terms of the chemical composition, but even within chemical composition we are talking about better efficiencies and better parameters in batteries, right? Now how an increase in battery efficiency and affordable pricing will change the end customer's perspective towards EV adoption?
Well, Mr. Rajiv, I think this is a straightforward question. So the moment you have an increase in battery efficiency, what are we talking about efficiency? We are talking about, the volumetric efficiency or the watt per hour that we are able to generate within the given space. So it basically gives out two outputs to an OEM. One, in the given space, you are able to package more energy. So that means they're definitely delivering good range to your customer. Second, if within the given package, at the same cost, if you are able to get I think it's a double win situation for them. And this has always been, at least over the last 10 years, every OEM is only being trying to target this particular point.
Fantastic, fantastic. I think, yeah, that's pretty straightforward. Now, my next question to Mr. Manikandan, right? Now, help us to understand, since, I mean, you have been witnessing this industry since 2007, right? The yeah. evolution and things like that. Do you recommend or do you suggest or advise that we have almost reached standardization in terms of battery technology and then the next leap step is the hydrogen fuel cell technology? Or do you still find there is a lot of gap to be covered between where we are right now in terms of battery cell technology and the hydrogen fuel, which could be for the, I would say, higher range vehicles?
Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, I would tell the others, I mean, advocate that there could be a lot of things can be done in terms of improvement in the existing technology, as Jules said, in terms of volumetric efficiency, the power per kilogram and all that. But more than that, I have another idea probably. For example, in a country like India, so we've been using the cells which is manufactured for a global conditions, where we in a lot of emphasis being put on the battery cell to operate on the minus 20, minus 40 degrees. But, you know, if, for example, in India, then we never get into that temperature. And why do we have to pay for that?
Yeah.
Yes. Right? So that kind of fundamental research is not happening in India. So we have to kind of focus on, you know, rather than being a consumer of the technology which comes from, I would say, either from China or elsewhere. But we'll have to see whether those technologies really, how much reliable it is for the operating conditions in India and how we can improvise. So we have the software skills and we have a lot of analytical skills, and we are called ourselves a software based. Yeah. Now, with these brains, probably if you are not even starting from scratch, I would rather request that you have to do a lot of fundamental research, start from scratch. As you rightly said, we are a little bit, you know, in a hurry. So probably take the existing solution and see how we can improvise on them with respect to our operating environmental condition in India. That could be one step that we can at least do that, right? So, and this is good scope and very good, you know, scope is there for that, according to me, both Thank in you. Terms of battery and other charging infrastructure and so on.
Understood. No, I think the interesting aspect is, even if you look at our the auto industry standards, right, our AS standards, or even if our norms, right,
yeah,
the emission norms, unfortunately, yeah, they are inspired from either right the Euro norms or the other norms. And actually, I think it's time for us to understand whether minus 20, minus 40 degrees is the something that we really bother about, or we probably talk about 40 degrees, 60 degrees, right? I think you're right, because we follow some already set in guidelines, and then the testing is also done accordingly, whereas the real temperatures are different.
Yeah.
Right? So this is an interesting thing. Now, let me take this question to Mr. Dev, right, who is producing these vehicles for a few years from now. So, Mr. Dev, tell me, with the change of, I would say, the setup, right, the testing environment to the real-life environment, which was basic, testing was basically driven by, I would say, Euro norms, and then the real life is actually driven by the Indian norms, right? How, as a manufacturer, do you strike a balance between these two?
No, I completely agree with the Manikandan's point that, you know, we need to optimize the design. So it all boils down to the, you know, the whole designing, as we call it, the zero-based design, and not just look for a jugaad or some kind of, retrofitting model, which is very popular here now. You know, I also would like to make a point what you said. You know, we are in a hurry. And the other side of it is, yes, I think in the modern world, which is so fast changing, we got to be in a hurry. But there is a difference, you know, there's a difference between rash driving and speed driving. You know, most of the time we are rash driving, so, and trying to take shortcuts and here and there. So I think as OEMs, we need to, focus, and it is not only the job of the OEM and the industry, but also academia, other stakeholders have to come into researchers, which typically doesn't happen here. And it happens very well in countries like Germany and other parts of the world, where you know a lot of industry-sponsored research work goes on, and then the learning comes back to the industry. So in a way, industry gains, you know, in the return on that investment is multifold. You know, probably more than what you would otherwise earn in your you know product life cycle P&L. So I think this is where the change has to come. From many of these technologies, and EV is such a disruptive technology, and riding on this EV is, I see a lot of integration of several other technologies, which even IC engine will industry will also gain. For example, artificial intelligence, IoT, connected cars, which are form factor agnostic, whether you're running on EV or hydrogen or IC engine, you know, all the cars will become intelligent cars, you know. So we need to see that, you know, what are some of these technologies and bring them out of the incubation or the lab and bring it to the scale in the industry. But we don't have to cut paste and copy paste everything, you know, that's probably wrong. And as Manikandan rightly pointed out, you know, why the hell do you need minus 20 degree, you know, a heater to heat up the battery? You need the other way around, you need to cool it down, you know. So my take on this is we have to go deep into it, and we have to get into a real you know, design-based, zero design approach while making the electric vehicle. Today, most of the cases, what we see is that, you know, take out the engine and the gearbox of IC and put back the battery and powertrain, and you have an EV. I think that is a wrong approach. We need to put our mind into the real zero-based, all grounds-up engineering, where the whole vehicle is designed around the battery per se. You know, like you see the modern cars, and you talked about the Lego approach. You know, now Elon Musk is toying with the idea of building the car in one go. You know, the entire shell of the car would be die-cast. Half of it is already there. So, I mean, these are the ways to do it. And people, some people initially thought he's mad, he's burning all his money, etc. But you know, all of them have been proven wrong. So, I think my view would be that, you know, we need to analyze each spec, each you know, the test standard, and what is applicable, and also customize and optimize it for India. That is the job of the industry, and there all the stakeholders, OEM, suppliers, academia, researcher, test labs, and some government agencies will have to come on board.
Very true. And I think thank you very much, Mr. Dev, for those insights. But I think electric mobility as an ecosystem developed more on collaboration than competition. That's what I could see, being part of this industry for the past 6 years.
Yeah.
I mean, there is never, I mean, people would complement each other, people would help out each other, people would support each other, right? I mean, that's great to see. And as you rightly said, the whole ecosystem has to come together to optimize the products, to optimize the technology, to customize it to the Indian needs, than to fall into the regular temptation of following some already set standards. At this point of time, that's a fantastic insights. And let me, I think there is one question from the audience, and I would like to direct this question to Mr. Tushar, right? Now, batteries also need electrolytes. Of course, they need electrolyte. And now the question from the audience is, does India need to depend for electrolyte on China, or are there possibilities of mining of those electrolyte materials within India?
So, as I said, again, I'm not an expert on electrolytes, to be very honest, to be very transparent about it. But just to give you a concept from the anode and the cathode part of it, as I said earlier, it's not only about mining. So, there are mining reserves which are available all over the world. The Chinese have managed to secure some of these mining reserves, especially in Africa. But there's still ample reserves out there. The processing part of it is something which China has monopolized to a large extent. And there's no reason why that can't be done in India. So I'm assuming it's a similar concept for the electrolyte part of it as well. And that's my short answer to that.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Tushar. And now this question probably to Mr. Huzaifa, right? This question is from the audience. Now the question is, what could be the possible second life business opportunities for EV batteries?
So I think the batteries, we all know when automotive batteries, they go through a lot of escalations in terms of charge discharge cycles, but if you look at second life options, which mostly in the part, many parts of the world they use is for UPS and for charging stations. So why? Because they charge slowly and they discharge slowly. There are no escalations or of charging discharge. So in India's perspective, we are still very nascent. The batteries, the first batteries that have gone are maybe 4-5 years old now, and still they have a lot of juice in it. So maybe they'll run on the road for maybe another 3-5 years more. And maybe after that, you'll find the vehicles that we have launched now 5 years back will now get back into second life work. So I think second life batteries will have a chance, and the way we need to charge batteries on the vehicles, we'll have a lot of charging stations requirement. So maybe I'm seeing a requirement of not using second life batteries for charging, but using a new fresh batteries for charging itself, because that's a demand we are creating now to offset the peak hour cost of charging. So that's something that we should look for. And India being a very vast and the reach of our mobility goes up to the last village, this could be one of the probable solutions of charging batteries in the city and discharging them going to the towns or villages where a good quality power is not available.
Thank you Huzaifa. Now while I encourage the audience to speak to ask their questions, but let me kind of summarize the wonderful discussion that we had so far. And I really want to thank each one of you, especially Mr. Huzaifa, for this fantastic Lego block idea. I really loved it. And Mr. Thank Dev you. Mukherjee, to talk about right how important it is to make customized right solutions for the Indian market. And of course, Mr. Samir Kumar Mishra, how you spoke about right different I would say key the challenges and how Indian OEMs can bring a lot of skin into their game in terms of stabilization and standardization. And Mr. Ujwal Iyengar, thank you very much for talking more from the ask perspective of what is it that an OEM demands from a battery. And Tushar, thank you very much for that wonderful presentation that you have started with, and for the way you have answered the questions. And Mr. Manikantan, I think very brilliant thing that you have said, that we need to get to the grassroots levels. We need to get to the fundamentals, right? We need to leverage the analytics, the software, and then the data strength that we already have and bring it to the EV industry. And with this, I mean, there cannot be a better discussion than this on the battery technology from the OEM's perspective, from the materials perspective, from the consulting perspective. And we have a fantastic group of audience, and it gives me goosebumps, and it also gives me immense confidence, and it gives me immense, I would say, pleasure in seeing that I'm able to see that one day, very soon, India would no longer remain as just a market, but it becomes a maker, it becomes an exporter, it becomes a leader, and becomes an epicenter of the EV revolution that's happening across the world. And kudos and thanks to the leaders like you who are driving it from the forefront. And thank you very much, e-mobility, for facilitating it. And this is Rajiv YSR signing off and handing it over to Hemant. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rajiv.
Thank you.
Lightly said, it's a nice moderator. Thank you very much to all our esteemed panelists for this wonderful session. Thank you, Rajiv. You did an excellent job. And again, I can't tell how much you contributed to the success of the session and how much we appreciate your willingness to do this. I can tell you by the emojis which are appearing on the screen, I can tell the session was so knowledgeable and so successful. Now the floor is, although you have missed the first session before starting of the day, staff can go and network with their peers and with our sponsors. Till then, bye from our end, and don't forget to join us tomorrow for one more exciting day.
Thank you.
And till then, thank you so much, Rajiv sir, and all our panelists.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you. You all have a great evening.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you. Aap log ko
ये बात